Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television addict. Television addict.
Television addict. Hello, everybody. Welcome to January 2020. I am Ken Reed, and this is TV Guidance Counselor, the weekly podcast in which I discuss classic television, meaning pretty much pre-millennium, but sometimes post-millennium, with interesting guests using back issues of TV Guide magazine as the gateway into our collective past. We are on to year 7 of the show, as I speak to you from a sleety, cold, depressing, dark New England here, which you may hear the sleet pinging against my window as I sit in my warm little dim office. But, you know, 2020's got to be better. Let's hope 2020 is better. And I want to thank you guys all who reached out or emailed me or messaged me on social media or all those things during the holidays. It is very much appreciated, and I very much appreciate you. This episode this week is one of my favorites. It's one of the last ones I did on my last trip to Los Angeles. Next time I'm out there is in March, so I'm working on some people for the show for then. But I waited on this one for a little bit because the podcast that these two ladies do was on a little bit of a hiatus, and it is back this week. The first new episode comes out tomorrow after a while. The podcast is called 75 Reads, and the guests are Joe Bozarth and April Bowlby. They are fantastic, so fun. You may remember April, as I mentioned her, probably as being on the Doom Patrol, which is one of my favorite shows of 2019. But this podcast is brilliant. They take the list of 75 books that David Bowie made that everyone should read, and they're reading each book and then going through the books week by week on the podcast. And it's a fascinating read. I'm a huge David Bowie fan. I enjoy reading books, and they're great, and you should definitely check the show out. It is highly recommended. Super fun show, and they're great. So I will put links up to 75 Reads on all of the social media for TV Guidance Counselor and TVGuidanceCounselor.com and all of that. Also, I have, I think, two of the cardboard retro TV phone viewers left. Thank you to everyone who bought them. I hope you enjoy them. If anyone wants one, they're $40 shipped. They are on iCanRead.com. You can buy them there. I have to hand assemble them, and then I will mail that out to you. They're fun. They're a fun, dumb thing. If you want to donate to the show, get something in return. Also, check out Knickknacks. It's a show that I mentioned. It's a YouTube show about the history of Nickelodeon, and it goes year by year. And in my New Year's cleaning, I got two boxes of my DVD-Rs of VHS rips of classic Nickelodeon, and I shipped them to the guy that does Knickknacks, and he's using them for the show, and I'm so happy to see them because they've just been sitting in my closet, and they're being better used with him. So Knickknacks on YouTube, go there and check that out. I often retweet him as well on Twitter, although how would I retweet him anywhere else? I guess people do that. They do memes. That's a whole argument I don't want to get into. On to this week's episode. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode with my guests, the hosts of the 75 Reads podcast, Joe Bozarth and April Bowlby.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
And my guests, plural, today, Joe and April, how are you guys?
We're so good. How are you?
So good.
Good. Thank you.
Hi.
Oh, we're sitting here poolside.
Poolside.
It's yes. Beautiful. Sunny,
I think we
California
should dive
day.
In after the show.
Yeah, it's very refreshing.
I'm looking at the jacuzzi.
Yeah.
Yeah, you are.
Well, the Airbnb came with an iPad that controls the jacuzzi.
No. Why are we not doing the show from the jacuzzi?
I know. We probably should.
No, it seems dangerous.
There is an electrical
thing. Yeah.
Although I could go battery powered, which
you,
you know,
hey,
we'd get shocked by like 18 volts.
We'll be back in 15.
How is there not a jacuzzi podcast? I'm actually surprised by that.
You guys, we could start.
I think
jacuzzi cast.
We
yeah,
jacuzzi
cast.
Yeah,
jacuzzi cast. Spa cast.
Yeah,
spa cast. Mm.
Jacuzzi sounds like a martial art.
It does.
To me.
Crickets.
Maybe I'm wrong. Yeah.
I remember when I was a kid, I think a jacuzzi, people would say it like in the 80s, we would say jacuzzi it or lose it.
No.
You grew up in California, didn't you? Yeah.
How can you tell?
Because I can't think of that as a verb, like, oh, no, it's cool. I'll just jacuzzi it. It'll be fine. Jacuzzi. Yeah, no, I know it looks broken, but I'll jacuzzi it. And then
it fixes everything.
It'll be perfect. Yeah.
It totally does.
Like a human washing machine. So we went sort of newlywed game style here. And you guys picked the same issue. This is October 19th to the 25th, 1985.
Yeah.
Which I think we're all of a similar age.
Yeah,
so we're all
little.
On the young side at this point and probably not watching that much primetime, although I was because I had bad parents. But
I was allowed to watch too.
Did you have a bedtime?
No.
I didn't either. Did you?
What? Of course I had a bedtime.
No.
Guys.
No bedtime. Did you have siblings?
I had a younger brother. I have still a younger brother.
Well, now he's older than me. I don't know what happened.
Yeah. I just stayed the same. He's only 2 years, 2.5 years younger.
Yeah.
So, but you know, we would get sleepy and fall asleep anyway. I mean, we would try to stay up, but.
Right.
That's kind of ingenious honest. I mean, I'm not a parent, but to be like, oh, you can stay up as late as you want. And then you just,
know.
Yeah, you know.
Exactly.
What was, do you remember what your bedtime was?
I feel saying? Like it was probably after a certain show.
Okay.
Probably like. Like, when I was falling asleep, my mom would notice and be like, it's time for bed. And I'm like, no, I have to stay. Look, I'm wide awake. But I know I always got scooted away from the television.
Thinking about it, most people I know, their bedtime was based around when a show was over.
Right.
And now I'm like, how did the parents do that?
Because they're clever. Because they like don't want any mess or fuss until they're done watching their show.
And now parents would be like, it's over after... Oh, no, you can watch whatever you want whenever.
Right. Well, you know what, though? There wasn't such a stigma on how long your kids sat in front of a screen back then. Because now it's like, oh, screen time's so bad.
Yeah. Well, you know, you have a baby.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do people give you guff about that?
Yeah. I was at... there's this cute, super cute, like, spinoff of Sesame Street, which I'm sure we all watched. And it's called... it's called the Furchester Hotel. Elmo goes to London and helps his family by the last name of Furchester run this hotel.
Wait, Elmo's name is Elmo Furchester?
I believe it. I know his family's last name is Furchester. You guys, it's the most darling. It's the
breaking news, everybody.
Furchester. And, you know, it's a monster hotel. And Cookie Monster is the chef at the hotel. Huh? And so... I'm at mommy and me class because I know nothing about kids, so I had to take a class, and I take my baby, and I learn things. And so one of the moms is like, I was talking about this show, and she's like, oh, Cookie Monster's the chef, so they eat cookies? I'm like, yeah, Cookie Monster, it's in the name. And so she's like giving me like the, she's like, oh, cookies, TV,
oh, no.
And I'm
might
like,
might as well just give a kid heroin and throw him in the pool.
I know, right? I'm just saying, I think our parents had it easier. But P.S., I look over 15 minutes later, and she's giving her kid marshmallows. So come on.
Yeah.
Lady. Yeah.
She's like, they're fat free. Yeah.
They're organic.
Yeah.
They're artisanal marshmallows.
I forge these myself. Out of sugar cane I grow. Yes. Yeah, I would have so much trouble just telling other parents not to go fuck themselves.
Yeah.
Honestly, it's hard. You know who are the easiest? Are doctors. They're the most laid back. They're like, they're fine.
Is it going to kill you? No, fine.
Do it.
Yeah.
Go run.
Have fun. I was a latchkey kid, obviously. So, just TV on.
TV.
Fell asleep.
Me too.
I love TV.
It was important. It was how we learned things.
It was how we learned things.
Yes, I agree. It was warm. It was always there for you.
Yep.
Yeah.
Never disappointed. And if you didn't like what was on, you would just switch the channel.
Yeah.
You hop between two shows. Did you ever do that?
Oh, all the time.
As soon as the commercial's on, you're like, what's happening with that show?
Yeah.
You could follow it still, weirdly.
Yes.
Like, I feel like I could still, especially talk shows. I would always flip between the talk shows.
Yeah, you knew. Yeah, you didn't have to watch the whole thing.
Yeah.
You could hop around.
You could hop around.
Let's see where that guest comes on. But you both grew up in California?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Around Los Angeles, or was it
I grew up in Northern California.
Yeah, Central.
Okay.
Central. So we were both up.
Yeah, up. More up. Yeah.
We were more up.
We were up.
Up with
but then
people.
As soon as we became adults, we were down. I mean, it's a close drive. It's not hard to get. I mean, California is a big state, but.
It's a big state.
But did this feel far away? Like, did Hollywood and all the stuff was being made feel accessible or still far away?
Super far.
It felt, once you're here, far away. The drive is short, but it feels far away once you're there.
Yeah. You know so it wasn't. When you were watching stuff as a kid, there wasn't an awareness of like, they make this right down the street.
No. We didn't even think about that, I don't think.
I thought it was just so far away.
Yeah, I don't even think I thought about where it was being made back then.
Right.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's just funny, the people I know grew up here, they're like, oh, yeah, no, we went to tapings. I saw Golden Girls taped and this thing. I'm like,
yeah.
What?
That's amazing.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah. That's not normal.
I think the only thing that we did, I think my dad took us to Universal Studios once when I was like six, and my sister got pulled out of the Star Trek line, and then they got to do like a Star Trek like visual video where she was like one of the pilots. And that was the closest thing to, I was like, wow, they make movies. Yeah. My sister's now in a movie at Universal Studios.
That's her Schwab. Yeah, exactly. She got pulled out of line, and now she's famous.
And now she's famous, you guys.
I do think, like, you do grow up, because my small town looks like middle America, so stuff was shot there all the time, and it was cheaper.
Do you remember any, like, examples?
Okay, I remember one time I was walking down Center Street, which was the main street in our town. And I didn't realize that stuff was I was oblivious. I was a little kid. I think I was with my mom, and I kind of walked away because it was a small town. You could do that. And she knew everyone who owned every store in the town. And I'm walking, and they were shooting The Best of Times.
Okay.
And I was very little. And someone walks by and is like, keep walking. I think it was someone in the back. I think I had wandered into the background or something. And then they cut, and someone's yelling at me. And I'm very, very small at the time. And I'm, like, almost in tears. And Robin Williams stopped them from yelling at me. And I will never forget that.
Aww.
And I was just like, he's like, oh, it's okay, honey. And I will never forget that.
How
he was
could
so
you?
Nice.
That's like an amazing, that's like,
and it's the best story in the world.
I was a tiny girl getting yelled at by, I don't even know who.
Yeah.
And he stopped them.
But you remember who saved you, and that's what counts. Yeah.
And it was Robin Williams.
Of
Mrs.
all people.
Yeah.
He's not even in that movie. He was just there.
I know. Shut up.
He had the day off, and he was just.
I mean, to me, he was
kids.
Mork.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Which Mork always made me uncomfortable.
Really? Why?
I liked Robin Williams, but he was so, like, unpredictable that it, like,
manic?
Put me a little on edge as a kid.
Sure.
Yeah. I was like, I don't know what's going to happen here. But then I like Jonathan Winters, who is more like that.
Yeah.
That's so interesting.
Yeah, I was like, oh, he's a little unpredictable here.
No, he is unpredictable.
Yeah.
You read that right. His relationship with Pam Dauber was weird because it was like sort of childlike, but they were like dating.
Right.
It was a little weird now that you mention it. Huh. Yeah.
Have I ruined Mark?
We just accepted it.
We just accepted it. He's from outer space. It's okay.
Yeah, he's just like that.
He's got cool suspenders. It's cool.
Yeah, rainbow suspenders are fine. That was what I was always like. He's like kind of like a kid, but I think they go on dates. I don't understand.
Yeah, like this isn't making sense to me.
Yeah, but out of all those Gary Marshall shows, that's the one I probably enjoyed the most because I was never like super Happy Days. Laverne and Shirley.
Oh, I love Laverne and Shirley. You did well. Yeah, get why you weren't like so into it.
I guess, yeah. I feel like girls I knew liked it more because it was a rare instance of like two female leads.
It's a buddy show.
Together.
Yeah.
You're my best friend.
Yeah.
I thought it was great, but sometimes it was sad. I kind of felt like there was kind of a, even as a kid, kind of like a there was a sadness to it. Like, they weren't kind of where they wanted to be.
Oh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I felt that as a kid.
I think that was so pervasive in just 70s shows in general.
Oh, right.
Like, even if it wasn't on like, Taxi, it was overt because everyone working at the taxi cab didn't want to be a taxi driver. But in every other show, it was kind of like, no one was like, I'm fulfilled.
Right.
It was all like, we're working towards a goal that's never going to happen.
I think you're right.
The 70s.
And then we get to the 80s and everything's like kind of perfect.
Glossy.
Excess is best.
Yep. Dynasty.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, because that was, I think that was when, and much smarter people than I have written, which isn't hard to be, but like, you know, examples of this where they're like, when we had Jimmy Carter, he was like, look, you guys, you fucked up pretty bad. Everything's kind of terrible.
Right.
So you got to look in the mirror and realize, hey, this is your fault. We'll work on it.
Yeah.
But then people were like, we don't like that. And they've just voted Reagan, who's like, everything's great. And if it's bad, it's that person's fault.
Right. Right.
So it was all aspirational.
Yeah.
It was really weird.
Yeah.
But yeah, you saw much less of those sort of failure shows.
Right. It went to an extreme.
Although Cheers, sort of.
I love Cheers. Come on.
Still love Cheers.
Cheers is a perfect show.
It is a perfect show.
It's so well written.
The pilot is a perfect pilot.
Yep.
Like,
yep.
It's
so good.
Is incredible. One of my things.
And I have to say, the best, for me, spinoff ever, Frasier. I love Frasier.
See, here's why I couldn't get into Frasier.
You couldn't get into Frasier.
because Frasier on Frasier and Frasier on Cheers were, it's a different character, basically. Right. And and this may just be a Boston thing. Mm. But I want to fight everybody. No. But the great thing about Frasier on Cheers was that he was an alcoholic,
right,
which was the sort of great equalizer on that show. So everyone in that bar, you have a mailman, you have an ex-athlete, you have a doctor, they're all alcoholics, so they all end up in the same level in the same place every week.
Yeah.
Which was kind of what was fascinating about that to me. And so him not being that was sort of like...
Him helping people?
Yeah. For some reason, it was like a disconnect with me. Where, right, like, yeah, if he was playing a character not named Frasier, I was a weird kid. But I probably would have been like, fine.
Fine.
Mm. For some reason, I was like, where's Lilith? What's happened? Right. Why is, yeah, he, what happened?
And they kind of explain it and kind of... Look, I had a big crush on Niles.
Oh, that's surprising.
Was that like your type or just this was a unique...
It was unique because I got married, I dated, I had a run of baseball players and then a run of musicians. Niles was neither of those.
Yes, yeah.
I love Niles. An intellect. Actually, Avi's more like Niles.
Of course he is.
That's funny. Avi is Niles.
Her husband.
So you basically married Niles.
From Philly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I married Niles from Philly.
Yeah. Philly Niles.
Yeah. Everyone Philly knows. Niles.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, but even Frasier, if you look at the change into the 90s, like, there's kind of no sadness in that show.
Yeah.
Even
yeah.
though it's, like, a dysfunctional sort of
Except, you know what was weird, though? When Daphne gets fat, and then they send her to fat camp, and she comes back, and she's different, and I didn't like it after that. It was weird.
Was that, did they have to write something in because of the actor?
I think she was pregnant. I think.
Okay.
And so the whole thing was, you know... It's after she and Niles finally get together, and she's like, "You put me on this pedestal, and I can't live up to who you want me to be, and now I'm gaining weight."
Ah, okay.
Oh no!
And it was kind of like, "Oh no, what's happening?"
Yeah, that's.
And
a
they
bummer.
Send her away to fat camp, or she goes away to fat camp.
Do they call it fat camp?
I don't know what they call it. She went to a place to lose weight.
Okay.
She went to a place to lose weight.
We could use the 1930s like reduction center.
Yeah, something like that. Like, she goes somewhere to lose weight, and she comes back thin. And, but it's just not quite the same after that.
Knowing.
That's an awful thing.
Knowing she was pregnant, that adds a weird sinister air, like where they would send people away to like convalesce and then they come back and they're, you know, they're fine. Yeah.
But I think that's why they had to write, I think. Not like on Will and Grace when they're just like, man, Grace, you're eating a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah.
She was totally pregnant and they didn't shoot around it.
There's almost every show where someone was pregnant, they didn't write it in, which they would sometimes get bit by, like on Married with Children, they wrote it in and then she ended up losing the baby.
Oh my God.
And they had to write it into the show.
Yeah.
Which is probably part of the reason they don't do that. But all the other shows, like I always think of Newhart and Julia Duffy was pregnant and they always have her holding a thing. Or it's just like really obvious because it's like, why do you have a beach ball? Like it wouldn't even have anything to do.
Right.
Yeah. And that's always funny when they do that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a weird thing to write in. It's weird that they sort of addressed it in the context of the show.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's like deaths in shows too.
Yeah.
Like they would sometimes write them in, sometimes not. Cheers did a good job with it.
Oh, yeah. Cheers. They were so great. Oh, I heard they had like, everything on that set worked too. Like they changed it into a functional bar, like because they were like, "How are we gonna make this unique and real?" And
do you remember the Frasier episode when they go back to the bar?
Yes, I did watch that one.
What'd you think about that?
That was a little weird.
It was weird. I didn't like it.
They wrote him more like he was in Cheers,
right?
Which I was like, there he is.
But it was weird how like they're trying to like avoid their friends. It was kind of a weird episode.
But that rung true with me for those people.
Yeah.
Because when I was a little kid, the Bullfinch Pub, which is now I think just called Cheers, but it's the bar that they base Cheers around, and it really looks exactly like that. Like they literally bought the rights to have the layout of that bar. And so when I was a little kid, my uncle worked near there, so he'd take me in there, and I literally was like, "Where's everybody? Like, why isn't that?" And he'd just be like, "Oh, they're not working today."
Cause that's so cute.
But it's so hard that you can't as a kid, you can't be like, it's a fictionalized version of this. So it was really bizarre to have, like, the real place be a place you could go to.
Yeah.
And it looks like the same.
Yeah. Alternate dimensional universe. Yeah. You're like, this is not the warm, happy place that I imagined. Yes. Why is everyone so grumpy?
There are drunk people here. Yeah. What's happening?
And it smells bad. Yeah. This is not what I wanted.
But, you know, that show... Also, like, being in Boston, it was hard to gauge how popular that show was for real with everybody.
Yeah.
Because you're like, oh, of course it's popular here. But then everyone loved Cheers.
Everyone loved Cheers. It was...
I don't know anyone who doesn't love that show.
Yeah.
The only people I know, like, just haven't watched it.
Yeah.
Like, they're like, oh, I don't really watch it that much. But then when they do, they all love it.
They love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't think of a...
It really holds up.
Show since then that kind of has
that. It has that love.
It brought people together. Like, people know where they were the season finale. Mm-hmm. Like, it was very important, I think, to culture. And they were our friends.
It's true.
They were. Sam Malone.
I miss him.
When I had Ted Danson on, he said a thing on the show that for some everyone, I got so many emails about it, where he said, the way I played Sam... He's very humble. Like, he's always like, oh, I don't do anything. It's all the writers.
He seems
super
like
nice,
the coolest guy in the world.
Nicest guy. But he's like, oh, you know, it wasn't me. The writers gave me, like, the best motivation ever with the character and his name. And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, well, his name is Sam Malone, which is Sam Alone. So I played him like he's going to be alone forever, and he knows it. And I was like, oh, but I get so many emails where people were like, oh, my God.
Yeah,
like, it was a rosebud or something.
You know?
Oh, my God.
I was like, what a genius actor. Like, you really turned that, like... I mean,
that was so beautiful.
That's very layered.
Right.
Yeah,
no. But clearly they didn't do that on purpose.
No,
he gives them credit. Like, they gave that to me. And I'm like, yeah, no, that's
just how his brain works. Yeah. He finds the gold.
And he does play it that way.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
And
totally.
That's the way it works.
So let's jump in on Saturday night and see what you guys both picked.
Saturday night.
The hottest night of the week.
So we're saying what we would watch now if we could... Jump back.
Yes,
time.
If we could turn on the TV and it would be this Saturday.
I like
October
time
19th.
Travel.
Me too.
We'll start with April. She picked first.
Well, obviously at 9 p.m. Golden Girls will be on, and that was the reason why we gravitated to this particular TV guide, because Golden Girls was on the cover.
Right.
And I have such good, Joe and I have such good memories. One of my memories is it was so special because Golden Girls would go, I would watch it today and I would watch it back then. my mom, she's a single mom and I have an older sister, so... Her favorite show was Golden Girls. So Saturday night, we would sit in front of... We would have dinner, and then we would sit in front of the TV on the couch, and my mom would have Rocky Road, like a gallon of Rocky Road ice cream. And we would just watch it and watch the Golden Girls. It was like the most magical, like, special little night.
That's and like I wonder, a perfect family bonding.
It's, well, right? And I wonder how many girls could... Because I did the same thing. Ours was popcorn.
Yes.
I did the same thing with my mom. But what was kind of uncomfortable is my mom would be like... Which one am I? And I'm like,
am I the horny one? Is that like, me? Like, no, there's no right answer there. Am I the stupid one?
I don't think I ever answered the question.
Yeah, you're like, ha, ha, popcorn.
Yeah, this popcorn's great.
Yeah, yeah, that's really putting the kid on the spot there.
That's tricky. I'm glad you didn't answer that. There would have been repercussions.
Right?
This one is a Dr. Dorothy dates also gets Blanche's pulse rate until he makes a pass at her.
Oh, yeah. I've seen this.
Yes.
He's like Italian or Spanish or something, isn't he? Like,
oh, that's the sculptor. You're thinking of the sculptor, maybe.
Thinking of the sculptor?
I think this is the one. Peter Hansen plays Elliot, the doctor.
And so I think she tries not to say anything, and then finally she does, but Dorothy doesn't believe her.
If I'm remembering correctly, this is one of those ones where you're like, oh, is Blanche all talk? Like, because she's all like, oh, no, I didn't mean, like, it's like a weird, and you feel kind of sad for her.
Right,
like,
exactly, because Dorothy accuses her of being a slut.
Yes.
And they make up in the end, and I feel like, you know, and they make up, and Blanche is very forgiving in the end. Like, it's okay, you know.
You know what I always forget? It's Blanche's house.
Yes.
Oh,
it's
gosh,
Blanche's
right.
home.
There's a pecking order there.
Yeah. They're her tenants.
They really need to shape up.
I mean,
maybe that's why she forgives her.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Well, but do you remember, like, in the very beginning, like, Blanche was going someone proposed to Blanche, and Rose was like, oh no, we're all going to have to move out. And Dorothy's like, but this is her happiness. And Rose is the one who's like, oh no, you wouldn't think.
But they dropped that kind of plot later. Like, right. They didn't really bring it up.
Yeah.
And I find the show super timeless because it is really 80s, but also, like, it doesn't, you kind of can't tell when it's set.
Yeah. Yes.
Because it's Miami, and that's what it looks like.
And right. Yeah, the houses are the same. Yeah. Maybe. Yeah,
yes. I agree.
And they're older women, and it's just like...
Well, and I feel, too, that now, with the way the economy is, people are, later in life, having to have roommates.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's not that much of a stretch.
Yeah, exactly.
I buy it. Which is,
in theory, kind of a sad thing, where, like, these women who are older now all have to... live together so right. that they can survive.
Right. So they can survive, yeah. Yes. And they're all working, you they know, past working. What you would think maybe retirement age. I don't know how old they were supposed to be. I can't figure that out.
Yeah, because they never really say.
They never out say.
They were
it.
All playing older
than they yes. actually were.
But I feel like they're all post. Well, no, I don't know if they're post retirement.
I don't
age.
Either.
I think they were in their 50s.
Yeah,
probably. I want to say like late 50s, maybe early 60s.
Maybe.
Because yeah. Sophia had to be up there. And she was like the mom.
70s, right? Yeah.
If she 70s, was Dorothy's 80s. Mom and they had kids younger then.
Well, she was in her probably early 70s and Dorothy was in her early to mid 50s.
Yeah, had to be, right?
Yeah. Even though she was the oldest of the
Isn't
actresses.
Isn't that amazing?
Isn't that something?
Yeah, and the youngest was Sophia. The
Sophia.
Yeah.
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 Isn't that great?
So wild.
Love her in Mannequin.
Oh my gosh, I forgot.
Stop it.
I forgot.
Yep, the owner of the department store.
I love that so much. So Golden Girls is the winner. Like, yeah, obviously we would watch
for the
that
win.
Again.
Yeah, you'd have to. Mm-hmm. I mean, Saturday Night NBC in the mid-80s was like that, because I was a huge Facts of Life fan. Give me a break.
Oh, yeah.
And then I'd watch Amen, even though I never liked it, but it was just on.
Yeah.
You had to kind of, it's on after Golden Girls. You're not going to do
that's
anything.
That's it. You don't turn the channel. But remember, like, later in, if we jump to the future a little bit, in the past, after Golden Girls, there was Empty Nest.
Yes.
Remember that show?
Yeah. Like, Richard Mulligan.
That was good.
Yeah. And then it had its own spinoff. So Empty Nest was a spinoff of Golden Girls, and then Empty Nest had a spinoff, the rare spinoff of a spinoff.
Oh.
Nurses.
Nurses! Oh. I forgot about that.
That was...
That woman, Park Overall?
Yeah.
The Southern lady who was like the... Yeah.
She was great.
Yeah. It was weird to have a spinoff of a spinoff. Yeah.
It didn't fly.
No. I think it made one season, and they really tried to do, like, integrated plot lines where they would try to get, like, people tune out after this. I remember they did a night, it must have been 92, where there was a hurricane in Southern Florida, and all the characters from all the shows, like, interacted with each other because of this hurricane. So, like, they had to go to the hospital. You know, like, the Golden Girls had to go to the hospital, and, like, the nurses were working there, and, like, Richard
That's
Mulligan
so cool.
drove them because he's their neighbor.
Oh,
and it
gosh.
Was, like, this weird...
That is
like,
so
make
cool.
it work.
Yeah. It's always weird when you would get crossover
episodes.
Yeah. Sitcoms. Yeah. That was always, like, even though it was just a... blatant
right.
attempt to get exactly. you to watch the
That's
show.
That's right.
Yeah.
But it works.
Yeah, totally.
If you
work.
Think there's a, if you see there's going to be a crossover, I remember that. Oh, it's a crossover. I have to watch
like
it.
It was big news.
Yeah.
Do they do that often now?
I think there were, I'm trying to think, well, what about like, when it wasn't a crossover, it's just introducing characters. I was trying
the
to think of Facts of Life and Different
thing.
Strokes did.
Well, Facts of Life had, the last season they had, I want to say 6 backdoor pilots to desperately try to keep that show going. And they had a ton of backdoor pilots over the years as well. And none of them went. I think Happy Days has the most spinoffs that were actual shows.
Mm-hmm.
Someone will email me and tell me I'm wrong, but I think it was either All in the Family or Happy Days had like the most spinoffs.
Oh, wow.
That were like viable shows. But,
interesting.
Yeah. And it was always, as a kid, it was always when you could tell that it was a backdoor pilot. Cause it was like, all of a sudden, everyone from the show isn't on it now after the first 2 minutes, and now we're in this, like, guy's store? What is happening?
Just abandoned.
Yeah, just a complete bait and switch.
Like this. Yeah.
Like, how stupid do they think we are here?
Right.
Yeah,
which is a totally lost thing. Like, they don't do those anymore because the way that the industry doesn't work that way anymore. You just have a show. You don't need to fool people into watching
it. No, yeah. About that. I know. They learned that, though. They've corrected that.
They course corrected. Yeah.
I wonder if just because they had to, because people were like, hey, we know what you're doing.
Yeah. Right. Where's everybody going?
Do you have a favorite spinoff? Do you remember one that you really enjoyed?
Well, I love Frasier.
Oh, yes, yeah, Frasier spinoff.
I love Frasier. I'm in love with Niles.
Oh.
Okay. But yeah, so, I mean, who doesn't love Cheers?
It's kind of shocking that's the only spinoff from Cheers.
Right. They could have, I mean, I feel like there were opportunities for more, maybe.
Yeah. Like, you could have done almost any character from that show could have had their own spinoff.
Yeah.
It's not like Frasier was, like, a standout character or anything.
No, that's true.
I would have watched Woody.
I know.
Woody would have been good.
His own show.
He gets married or something. Yeah. That's how it ended. Or he was married. Right. Or,
yes.
Even Norm?
I would have...
Oh, I'm sorry. There was another spinoff.
What was it?
The Tortellis.
I don't remember
that. It was Carla's ex-husband, who was played by Dan Hedaya, I think. And it was the family sitcom about them. So it was the Tortellis, which I totally forgot.
I need to look that up. I don't remember that.
It was one season. Uh-huh. People often would get it confused with the Torkelsons, which was a southern show. Yeah. But yeah, the Tortellis, I think it was maybe less than a season, but I remember liking it. It was like
You go find that.
Yeah. Watch their home life, this big Italian yelling family.
Sure.
Yeah. Totally.
It's fine.
It's my family.
Anything else on Saturday you guys had?
And I feel like it might have screwed up because I think it's a time conflict. Look, Give Me a Break was on. Facts of Life was on.
Facts of Life.
227.
Loved those.
I love 227.
We also watched that show. Jack A. Harry.
So good. So
rare show set in D.C.
Right?
Weirdly.
And just on that porch. Yep. Like those steps. There's just those ladies sitting on those steps.
Hanging out. I always describe that show as Hal Williams, who plays Mary's husband. He just wants to eat his dinner and Mary causes problems. That's every episode of that show. He's the most reasonable character.
That's the most reasonable character.
Like, he just comes home from work and he's like, come on, Mary.
She's just like,
here's
Mary.
A crazy thing.
Where
he's like,
that.
I just want to eat my dinner.
I just wanted peace and peace.
Just feed me.
But, okay, so maybe not the most popular pick, but if I were to go back right now, a big one that night for me would be Gunsmoke.
Really?
I love Gunsmoke.
Okay, were you a fan of just Westerns in general?
I loved Westerns.
Do you still like Westerns?
Yes. During my I have a 1.5-year-old, and my whole pregnancy was Golden Girls and Gunsmoke. Mm. And I love Gunsmoke. When Miss Kitty left and they brought someone else in, I was like, what?
Did you like it as a kid, or is that a new discovery?
I liked it as a kid. I like it now. I liked The Big Valley. I liked all the Westerns. I still like all the Westerns.
It's weird because that was the prominent TV genre for like 25 years.
It was good stuff.
No one cared.
Right.
It never came back. It really didn't.
It never came back. I wonder why.
You can bring it back, Joe.
We can bring it back.
How about this?
Campaign.
Western, but all 50-year-old women.
Ooh.
Oh, like
they're
combo.
Like Golden Girls.
They're
posse.
All living it.
Didn't they make that Bad Girls or something?
Yes. Was that Sharon?
Right.
Oh, no. Sharon Stone was Quick and the Dead. Bad Girls was like Mary.
Drew Barrymore?
Masterson.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Drew Barrymore. Yeah.
They're not in their 50s.
No. Not in their 50s.
That's why it didn't work.
Maybe.
I think you're right.
They're
Bad
like
Girls
a,
too.
Bad Girls too.
Yeah.
They're like bounty hunters and they're in the, and they have to do it because their husbands died in the Civil War.
That's right.
And, so they're gonna go make some money. You know? Yeah, I'd watch that.
I'd watch that.
Too, yeah. Actually,
I would totally watch that.
Would you watch that with like your family, the Westerns? Or you just kind of just.
I would watch it with my dad.
Okay.
So my dad and I would watch Westerns. Most of my taste in television comes from my dad. Like I would watch boxing with my dad. I'd watch 60 Minutes with my dad, and I'd watch Westerns with my dad. And Alfred Hitchcock Presents and The Twilight Zone with my dad.
Okay. That's a pretty good education there.
Yeah.
Is there anything like that that you watched that was sort of not typical for a child at the time?
A child. No. I mean, my mom would watch Silk Stockings.
Okay.
Oh, yep. I remember that.
And then I would like kind of like, I'm going to bed, Mom. And then like you know, when you're like sneaking around the corner. Because it's not that I understood what was happening. I just knew I couldn't watch it. So I was like, I'm going to find a way. But I think I watched most television with my mom, not my dad. My dad was more like a turn on the HBO, kid. Like, enjoy. Like, yeah, whatever you want.
It's all free. Yeah, and it's all rated R.
Do it. And then he would, like, play video games mostly. Okay. he was an RN nurse who worked the night shift. So that, for him, he just did not have time for TV. Yeah. But my mom was more like, we're going to watch Designing Women.
I love Designing Women.
Designing Women was so good.
It's all on so Hulu great. Now. They just added it.
No. Yeah. Well, I know and what we're doing later.
The Sugar Baker, here we come.
I mean, that show, to me, that show holds up. Like, it's
it totally holds up.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And I also had a weird, like, visceral aversion to Southern shows when I was growing up.
Did you really?
I was just so Northeast that, like, anything super Southern, I was like, I don't understand. Like, Mama's Family, I cannot watch.
I love Mama's Family. I didn't like it as a kid.
Yeah. I like it now. I did not like it growing up.
Yes. I loved it today and yesterday.
I just, something about it, I was like, I don't get this. But, like, Designing Women, I loved. I was like, finally. A Southern show I can enjoy.
And that's it, because it's not so over the top.
Right.
And the accents
Delta Burke did have a pet pig.
Annoying. What's that?
Delta Burke did have a pet pig.
Oh, that is, well, I mean, but Delta Burke could have a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
She could have a pet pig.
So funny.
Also, Mama's Family, she was always yelling.
Yes.
That's true. Maybe it was the yelling.
You know what I really hated? Bubba.
I didn't like Bubba.
It was too dumb. It was, like, too much.
Yeah. It was just over the top.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because maybe there were caricatures, so you're like...
It's kind of like bad sketch.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's how it started.
Yeah,
it was a Carol Burnett show sketch.
Yeah. Exactly.
And the first season had, like, Rue McClanahan and Carol Burnett, and then when it went into syndication, they were all gone, and Betty White, and now it was, like, a bunch of second stringers, and everyone's weird, and then, as a kid, I was like, no.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah.
And also, like... I was like, Vicki Lawrence, like, I'm not convinced you're an old lady, so now I feel uncomfortable because you're in disguise.
Yeah.
Like, don't trick me.
Yeah.
Like, kids don't like
that's kind of the joke, but, like, you're definitely not an old lady, so what's happening here?
Exactly.
Yeah, kids, maybe it's just me again.
I'm with you.
Let's see, I'm curious what the Facts of Life one is this week. Natalie's boyfriend, played by Yves Andre Martin, appears in a popular beefcake calendar of the Langley swim team, a calendar that is frowned upon by the College Board of Regents. I do remember this episode. This was
Stop it.
There was a weird phenomenon of, like, college hunk calendars in the mid-80s.
I don't remember.
Yeah.
Well, I believe that.
That's how Mark Harmon got his career started.
No way.
And Ted McGinley, they were like
Ted McGinley was good looking.
Oh, yeah, but they were
still
like,
good looking,
I'm going to USC. I'll be in this hunk calendar.
And then they get, like, cast and stuff. Make some money.
Yeah.
Good it was for them.
It's that weird Chippendales era.
Chippendales, yes. That was a thing.
Yeah, there was a lot of that in the air.
Playgirl?
Yeah. It was like just
Lady hunks. Power. The
Lady
80s.
Power we like, created the
shoulder
hunks.
Pads in.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. The hair, we're going.
Yep, and we'll get our own beefcake calendars. That's and right. We can go into a Spencer Gifts and buy our own offensively terrible calendars.
Yes. Oh, my God.
But this was, he couldn't go to college because they were like, you're in this calendar with no shirt on. Forget
oh my
it.
Gosh.
Yeah.
Wow, how things have changed. Yep.
My.
No, it's like, I see you've listed in your extracurriculars. Nude modeling. This is for charity, though, so it's good. It's
beautiful.
Anything else on Saturday, or are we on to Sunday?
On to Sunday.
Let's go on to Sunday here. What do we got? We'll start with you.
Alfred Hitchcock, for sure.
Yeah.
Tonight for the main course, a murder most rare.
clever play on words.
I like it.
This was in 85. There was a huge resurgence of anthology shows. So we had the new Alfred Hitchcock Presents, which remade old episodes, and then they colorized the original introductions. So Hitchcock would still introduce them, even though he was dead, which is a little weird.
That's a little weird.
And they did the new Twilight Zone started in 85, which I loved, and Amazing Stories, and there was a bunch of stuff called
Monsters? I used to stay up late at night and watch Monsters, Tales from the Crypt.
Tales
from the Darkside. Yep. You never know. And then it like did the negative
and
screen.
It's so video cheesy, but
so
it's terrifying.
Good.
Yeah.
Those were so well written.
Not as brightly lit.
Not as brightly lit.
George Romero produced those, who did the Dead movies, Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead. They were all made in Pittsburgh.
Oh my gosh.
And they were mostly all bottle episodes. Like, there's a Tales from the Darkside where Jerry Stiller is like a radio DJ who's being possessed by a demon. The whole episode's just him in a radio booth. There's no other characters.
That's so genius.
Wow. Yeah, because it's a cheap show.
Yeah.
And Monsters was the spinoff series of Tales from the Dark Side.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And it was like the more comedic
version. It was good.
Yeah.
They were both so much fun.
They're super cheesy.
Super cheesy.
I love it.
So good.
Yeah, I really enjoyed them. Did you ever see them?
No.
Oh, they're so good.
They're great. They're all streaming now.
Well, yeah. It's a Halloween almost.
Oh, we've got to do it, girl.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's a Christmas episode of Monsters and one of Tales from the Dark Side. And I had Jenna Von Oyon, who was on Blossom. She's
oh,
six.
Oh, yeah.
She's in both of them as a kid for some reason. And the Monsters episode is the craziest thing. It's called Glim Glim.
And oh, I love that.
About this monster who looks like a Christmas tree. And there's like an apocalypse. It's just insane.
Oh, my gosh.
It's insane.
Glim Glim.
Glim Glim.
Glim Glim. We need to watch that.
Yes.
It does sound like such a scary Christmas tree.
No, that one's not super scary. Because the twist at the end just makes it really sad.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So I'm going to give it away to you.
Yes.
So Glim Glim. Basically, there's like some kind of weird dome is put over the town. And so they're like, oh, the aliens have invaded. And Jenna Von Oyen and her dad are like hiding out in the basement of this library. And Glim Glim, this monster, is always roaming upstairs and they don't know what. And why is he in the library? And then Jenna Von Oyen ends up being able to communicate with him. And this monster's not a monster. He's trying to learn English in the library.
Oh, no.
And he dresses up like a Christmas tree because he's like sort of weirdly Christmas tree shaped. And they see him and they kill him and they shoot him. And then you see he has a little piece of paper that says, "We wrote Merry Christmas on."
Oh, my God.
And it's like the saddest thing. And you're like, no.
That is the saddest thing.
Oh,
yeah.
No.
Yeah, that disturbed me as a kid so much. I cried. I was like, Glim Glim just wanted to say Merry Christmas.
Oh, my God.
That's, whoever wrote that is twisted.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's like the day the Earth stood still. It's kind of the same plot where the guy comes out and they shoot him and he's like, I was trying to help you.
Oh, my God.
But this is heartbreaking.
I feel so sad.
Don't show your kid that
one. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. I will not be showing anyone. Yeah. Oh, that's, Glim Glim. But I do want to watch it.
It is kind of fun.
Glim Glim is like for glimmer. You know it's not a bad...
Oh, and he's so cute. I had a guy named Steve Johnson on who was a special effects guy and out of his mind. Like, he was like 19 from Texas, came out here in 85 and just was coked out of his mind all the time making special effects for stuff, and they just let him do whatever he wanted. And he did Fright Night, if you've ever seen that.
Yeah.
He told me a story where he's like, I wanted the dissolve of the vampire at the end not to be like how it normally is, so I invented basically liquid nitroglycerin, and you have to throw the acid on and then a base to the... And he's like, so I'm throwing this on, and I'm having a great time, and get the shot, and I'm driving home, and my feet really start hurting, and I look, and my shoes have totally dissolved from the acid.
What?
No. Chemical burns. But he told me this story where he did a Monsters episode, and the plot was like a woman was like, oh, I want this guy to love me forever. And then he dies and he comes back as a zombie because she didn't think it out.
Yeah.
But the big like payoff is he's supposed to go, oh, you forgot about my organ donor card. And he pulls his like hospital gown and his organs all fall out.
Oh! But I love that.
Which
that's
is great. But Steve's like, the guy was in a rig that was like his head but a fake body and he's on a board so he can't move.
Right.
And he kept getting his line wrong. And Steve goes... We wouldn't have thought the guts looked like this, but because of what he said, everyone was like, when the guts come out, they look like a dick.
Yeah.
And he goes, the guy's line was supposed to be, you forgot about my organ donor card, and he kept saying, you forgot about my organ parts. So they had this shoot, and this guy would be like, you forgot about my... boom, organ parts. And they're like, no. And they had to keep, because it takes forever to reset this thing.
Yes.
And he's like, we were there for so long.
Oh, no.
Organ donor card.
Like, organ donor card.
Oh, just my God. Love this line for you.
So I had to rewatch that one after he told me that story. And I'm like, this is amazing.
Oh, my
this
God.
Is
that's
so,
fantastic.
Yeah. That one's less sad than Glim Glim.
Yeah, that poor sounds Glim Glim. Hilarious.
That's less sad.
I would like to watch that, actually.
Yeah.
Now I know a little history behind
it. Exactly.
Yes.
It's like a little commentary.
I, too, would like to see. We'll just have to watch it ourselves. We can't subject other people to the sadness.
No, we'll watch it privately together.
Private screening.
Together. That's what I always say about the show. I'm like, yeah, this is about us all watching television alone together.
Yes.
kids.
Yes.
That's what we're doing. So Sunday night, you did Alfred Hitchcock Presents, and then what did you do, April?
I did Murder, She Wrote.
Oh, both murder.
Murder.
Yes, murderer.
I mean, Angela Lansbury is
that's
great.
That's what I'm saying. Angela Lansbury, although, like, dark and creepy feeling, my mom was a big Agatha Christie fan, so she would watch this, and just the music, and Agatha, and Angela Lansbury on her bike, and she's the only woman, and she's got the most calming, soothing voice.
Yes,
so
she does.
I feel like when things are getting crazy in the town, you feel settled because Angela Lansbury is there.
She's unflappable. Like, she's never, no matter what's going on that show, she's just kind of like, eh.
You kind of like, want to be as cool as her.
That's what, she must be Canadian, I feel. Because, like, I'm just like, what's happening under that? You know, just like her
she
little
is unflappable.
Feet are paddling.
She's got no darkness.
Tell.
Well, I mean, I guess she's like that in Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Yes.
And she's like,
all the magical, like, no, I just feel safe with her. She's Mrs. Potts.
She's wonderful.
Beauty and the Beast.
But Murder, She Wrote, even though literally everyone's being murdered every week, as a kid I was never like, it didn't seem like anything bad was ever happening.
It wasn't scary to you.
I guess it wasn't. She was always writing letters, maybe. Very...
It's like, you know, murder.
It was the Agatha Christie murder. It was like somebody has a knife in their back and they just look sleeping. Like, it was never... You didn't see
it wasn't
autopsy.
Gory.
Yeah, it wasn't. Yeah. And it didn't have that... Even Alfred Hitchcock Presents, like, it was like... Yeah, quaint murder.
Exactly. Like, who done it?
Yes.
Nothing sensational in that.
Right.
The Alfred Hitchcock that night is Murder Me Twice.
Oh.
Buck Henry, who wrote the script, plays the prosecutor in a trial of a woman played by Barbara Hershey, who killed her husband while hypnotically transported to a past life.
Wow.
All been there.
Layered.
I feel like this may be completely apocryphal and I may just be making this up, but I seem to remember a case in the 80s where someone used that as a defense.
Oh, no.
I feel like that happened.
That doesn't surprise me.
Because I was.
In real life?
Yeah. So it was around the time where the guy had the cotton candy defense. Do you remember that one?
Yes. That cotton candy made him crazy.
He said he ate so much cotton candy he went nuts and killed his wife.
Yeah,
that was
you
his
know.
Defense.
Was he a diabetic?
Because cotton candy.
No.
Oh,
well. He was just like, well, you know, it was just, but I ate so much of it. And they had, like, experts who, on, like, on cotton candy, I guess. They had a person be like, well, I guess just for the amount of sugar, and it was, like,
That's a truckload
of cotton candy.
Yeah.
And I'm like, who would... Like,
who's even listening to this
right
now?
And who
with
eats that much cotton candy?
A crazy person. A murderer.
He was crazy.
So that's what he did. He was already nuts.
Yeah.
But, like, your lawyer's like, I got it. I guess foolproof.
He's like, I got it. Would you eat that
candy.
Day?
Yeah.
Cotton candy.
We just, a ton of it, right? I don't know. No, you ate
you
a ton
ate
of
a
it.
A lot of candy.
Yes.
Was it blue or pink? This is important.
Focus.
Yeah. Well, we don't believe you. You said it was blue, and we all know the pink kind's what causes murder.
Yes, exactly.
I hate it.
Throw a book
candy.
At him.
I hate cotton candy.
Oh, it's disgusting.
It doesn't do what you want it to do.
No, it doesn't.
It's very pretty.
It's pretty and it's cool to watch them make it.
Yes.
But then it's like gritty and gross.
And it messes with your fingers.
And then when they have cotton candy flavored other things, you're like,
ew.
This is just the bad part.
You guys, they genetically modified grapes. There's cotton candy flavored grapes.
That's disgusting.
Did you know that?
No.
Yes.
I've tasted those.
Yeah.
Do you think they taste like cotton candy, though?
I think they don't taste like grapes.
Yeah. I don't know what
do you
they
think they
like.
Screwed something up and they were like, we'll just tell them it's cotton candy.
Yes.
That's closest thing it is.
Yeah. I think they were trying
a blanket
to perfume
flavor.
Something and they were like, oh, it's sugary.
Yeah.
Do they make wine out of it or anything?
I don't think so.
Because that makes more sense.
Grapes.
Like, cotton candy wine.
I think it's table grapes. Right?
Table
like, you just
grapes.
Eat
yeah,
them. And they're big. They're
grapes,
big, aren't
big,
they?
Fat,
they're kind of fat.
Table grapes?
They're big grapes.
Yeah.
They're big, fat grapes. Fat, big
okay.
grapes.
We're going to Google it.
Okay.
We'll Google it.
I've never heard the term table grapes.
Oh, yeah. Once you don't stop and drink.
I've heard table wine.
Once you don't stop and drink.
Can we get some grapes for the table? out here. You both passed up what I would be watching.
What was it?
There is a made-for-TV movie. This is a big deal.
I Dream of Jeannie 15
All
years
new
later.
I Dream of Jeannie 15
please,
years later.
Please look.
You do have it. Okay, you have it. You have it.
I did
you didn't
I
have it.
It.
Because Barbara Eden, hello.
Yep. And this is, I was such a sucker for, like, what are they doing today? Update things.
Yes, and they used to do those.
Yep. We had the new 85. We also had the new Leave It to Beaver, which was an update with the original cast.
Oh. When did they do the Brady Bunch update movies?
1990.
90.
Well, they tried in 79. They had a thing called the Brady Brides in 79.
Yes, I remember that.
And it was a failed pilot that was made for TV.
It was Jan and Marsha, right?
They had a fake Marsha.
A fake Marsha.
But then in the Bradys from 1990, they had a fake Cindy.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. The weirdest thing about that one is they did the Very Brady Christmas. That was the sort of made for TV
movie. Yes, I remember that.
But it's a drama. Because 30-something was really popular. They did the Brady's as a drama, and then they had a regular weekly series called The Brady's that was, like, about them getting divorces and cheating, and someone has cancer. Yeah. It was like,
what happened to The Brady's?
Yeah, the thing I love about The Brady's is yuppie problems from 1990. Yeah. Like, it was the weirdest thing.
What?
It's real weird.
That's very strange.
And it was, like, shot on... It was, like... Just seeing sitcom characters in a drama all of a sudden is not how I would do that.
No.
I think I'd like to leave my memory of them back in the, what was it, the 60s?
70s. 70, well, 68 to 72, I think it went. Do you have a favorite?
Because we were already watching all that stuff in reruns.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, that was the quintessential rerun show.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite Brady Bunch episode?
I have several that I love.
Wow, you have several.
But you know when I'm hiking sometimes, I what pops into my head was when Bobby and Cindy got
off. Bobby! Cindy! In the Grand Canyon?
Yeah. That cracks me up. So every now and then on a hike, if you are beer hiking and you hear Bobby, Cindy, it's probably me on the other side of the hill.
Oh, you love
I love that.
And they meet the little native boy.
Yes.
And he saves them and they're like, is he a ghost? I don't know. But he's not.
But he's not.
He's not.
I go with the Hawaii Vincent Price ones.
Oh, Vincent Price.
Yeah. And he's all 60s cool Vincent Price.
Yeah.
His Viva Las Vegas Hawaiian gear.
Sure.
Yeah.
With the tiki.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. That's a good one. I had Robbie Rist on who plays Cousin Oliver.
Oh, Cousin Oliver.
Poor guy. He's like, I had a job as a kid for 2 weeks and everyone hates me. He's had a good, like, he did one of the Ninja Turtle voices.
Oh, okay. That's good to hear.
Yeah, but he was just like, what the hell?
He's like, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know what I signed up for.
Like, he's like, I was an 8-year-old kid. I got a gig. And, like, literally people were like, you ruined the Brady Bunch, you son of a bitch.
Like,
I'll kill you. Yeah.
I don't think he ruined it.
No. It was on the downslide.
It was already, I mean, once they all started getting perms,
That's true of all shows.
Yeah. Oh, the perms?
Yeah.
Perm kills it?
Perms is downhill. You know how, like, your favorite band, once they put out that album where they all have beards, you're like, the perm is the TV show version, I think.
The kiss of death for the TV show, the perm.
Yeah.
Yeah, when they all started getting perms, I was like, I don't know.
Something's wrong.
They fired their whole hair and makeup team to one person, and they're like, I only know how to do perms.
Sorry, guys. Like, so we're
going to
do this.
Is everyone cool with that? Just everyone has the same one?
Everyone's good?
It's easier for me.
Yeah.
We can do that. Have you gone to the Brady House?
I have not.
Really?
Uh-uh.
It's in Studio City. It's not far from here,
yeah.
Did you, when you moved here, did you go to anything like that? Was, like, there any iconic or, like, shooting locations or anything you had to go to?
You've been to the Bronson Caves, though,
Oh,
right?
Sure, yeah. I used to hike there all the time.
I have not
Or
done
walk
that
my dog yet. There. It's not really a hike.
Either.
Yeah.
It was at the end of my street when I lived in Hollywood off of Canyon Drive. We would just walk the dog up to the end of Canyon Drive, go into the park, and go look at the Bat Caves.
Yeah, this is where the Batmobile came out.
Yeah,
this
is
where, like, Kirk fought the Gorn.
Yeah.
It is weird like that.
Isn't there a Happy Days house here, too?
Yes, yeah, okay. The Happy Days house here. That's in Hollywood. Sherman Oaks, maybe?
Oh, maybe Sherman Oaks.
The Arnold's house from the Wonder Years is, like, two streets over from here where we are now.
Stop it.
And
Three's Company was supposed to be in Santa Monica, and I'm like, was there really a Regal Beagle? Like,
In the 70s? There had to
had
be.
Had to be, right? There had to be.
Whenever I'd watch Love Connection, and it was all, like, that weird, sleazy, just post, like, swinging 70s, but still the people kind of hanging on to not giving up the ghost.
Yep.
They're all Regal Beagle people. They're all like, so I met her in Santa Monica.
Yeah.
And we went to a jacuzzi bar. Like,
And they said, jacuzzin or lose it.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
That's right. Let's do a little throwback.
Chuck Rohr was like, you know, if you'd like to jacuzzi again, we'd be happy to pay for it. He blocked me on Twitter.
Chuck Woolery.
Super racist now.
Really?
Oh, my God.
Oh, no. Yes. That makes me so sad.
He's like super right-wing racist.
You're kidding.
Like insane.
Chuck Woolery?
Oh, God, yes.
Oh, yeah. That makes me sad.
Yeah.
That's
of all the people. Yeah. I think those guys who were like super wealthy in the 80s and then like the 90s, no one cares about them. They're like, it must be because of the Jews.
Right.
Or something. And you're like, whoa, wait a minute. What?
Like what?
Yeah. Come on, Chuck. You're a game show host. Yeah, but that's, I always associate that with the sort of 70s Three's Company.
Right.
That whole
come and knock on our door.
Yeah.
Ropers. I go to South Pasadena to see a lot of the houses.
I love South Pass. I live very near there.
Pretty in Pink House.
It's in South Pass. South. You're kidding.
It's exactly the same. It's right by the train tracks. It looks like Harry Dean Stanton's going to be out front smoking.
Do I see it all the time and not know it? I'm there all the time.
Well, you probably do. And once you know, you're like, yes, obviously. Because it's literally exactly the same. Same color, same vegetation out front.
Why do I not?
And then, did you ever watch My So-Called Life?
Yes.
The Chase's house is in South Pasadena.
That was like the best show ever.
The Chase's house is there, and Brian Krakow's house is right across the street.
You're kidding
me. That's in South Pasadena. Pee-wee's house from Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Yes. What? I'm going to need to get some addresses from you when
I'll give you guys a map. They're because, all in like two blocks
of
each
other. That's 10 minutes from my house.
You got to go.
You're kidding me right now. That's like a tour of my youth.
Yeah. Oh, it's crazy. That's every time I come out here, I do it, and I'm like... And I never take pictures of like celebrity foot, but those I'm like, I got to. It's the house for My So-Called Life. Yeah.
Oh my God. My So-Called Life.
If we were to do like a star tour, would they take us to those places?
No.
No,
they'd take you to like, they'd take you to like where people live.
Okay, right.
We're going to do our own tour. We don't care where they live.
The cool thing about like smartphones and stuff now is it's so easy to do.
You just
write it and it comes in there. Yeah. And like the apartment building from Punky Brewster is on Wilshire, like right in Koreatown.
Is it really?
Yeah. It's just,
I bet we've driven by it a million times and don't even.
And then once you know, there's a comedy show I used to do on Vermont Ave at the Virgil, or Virgil Ave at the Virgil.
Mm-hmm.
And the police station from Nightmare on Elm Street is there, but it's a library. But I parked in front of it once and I was like,
why does this look familiar?
This creepy feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the house from Nightmare on Elm Street's right off of Sunset, and it's just on one of those side streets, like, by Sunset and Fairfax.
Okay.
Just there. And it's on the same street as the two houses from Halloween.
Oh, that's so funny.
It's really weird. Just people living them. Just houses.
Just hanging out.
Yeah.
Just houses.
I need to get some addresses from you.
Oh, yeah. I'll give you a list.
I need a list.
Yeah. Amazing.
The Pretty in Pink one, really, I was like...
I'll probably cry when I see it.
Yeah,
Tears of joy.
My So-Called Life one, I did tear up a little bit.
I mean, that was such a big show for us, right?
Yeah.
My So-Called Life was...
Because we're all probably that exact age.
Do you
at that
remember
exact
when Rayanne was going to be singing and then she had the stage fright and then she couldn't do it? Oh, and I loved her mom. The best part of meals are the appetizers. I'm like, yes, Rayanne's mom's so cool.
She's a free spirit. But she had a drug problem.
Yeah, she did. Yes, she did.
Well, it's funny because like that show... took place in Pittsburgh, outside of Pittsburgh.
Oh, I don't think I knew that.
But it, you know, shot all here.
Yeah.
Which in hindsight now, I'm like, oh yeah, this palm tree. Like, you notice it later.
Yeah.
But that felt the most like where I grew up outside of Boston. Like, that's exactly what it was like.
Wow.
And it's funny because all the music on that is like Boston people, like Juliana Hatfield and Buffalo Tom. And they're all like,
Buffalo Tom,
people
so
that
good.
I know. Like, they're from, like, I've had them on the show. Like, it's
that's
really
so
weird
cool.
that I'm like, but you wrote My So-Called Life.
Yes.
How does this happen?
Part of your youth.
Yeah, yeah. The soundtrack to that still gets a lot of play in my car.
Now I want to stream My So-Called Life from beginning to end.
It holds up.
Well, I think we need to.
It's so freaking good. We have time off.
We have time off.
We can do this.
Yeah. The Christmas episode is particularly heartbreaking.
I'm trying to remember.
Ricky runs away because he gets kicked out of his house because he's gay.
Yes!
Ricky.
And Juliana Hatfield plays a homeless kid who might be a ghost.
No.
Yeah.
This is a very emotional day.
I'm sorry. This is all the feels are coming up to
me. Oh, my God. So many feels.
Let's move on to Monday. Maybe it'll be less emotional. Oh, did you pick your...
Oh, you picked
your Sunday. Yep.
We did Sunday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just got excited.
What did you do
Monday?
On Monday, April?
So, we were... Jeopardy.
Okay.
Yeah, Jeopardy.
Every night, Jeopardy.
He's
family?
Also got a very. I like shows with relaxing voices, like Alec Trebek.
Who is Canadian?
Oh, see, I think you have a hidden thing for Canadians.
I
do.
Canadians.
They're
in my
very
life.
Lovely people.
Lovely, yeah. Calm, just
so
funny.
Nice.
Yeah.
So Jeopardy, Three's Company, which we kind of touched
love.
On. Barney Miller. Like, I was too young to really remember it, but I know that my grandpa would watch it a lot. He had like this soda machine tab. Like, he had a tab soda machine, and we would get that. And then we'd sit and we'd watch Barney Miller.
Oh, that's
so nice.
He had
a tab machine in his house?
Like a proper tab machine.
That's so cool.
Like one you would find in like a diner.
The vending machine.
Like little spoof. Yeah, sprickets, sprouts.
Wow.
I don't know.
He just loved tab.
He just loved
tab. That is real love for tab.
That's real specific, too.
Yeah.
My grandpa was a particular kind of guy. Yeah.
Is it time for Tab and Barney Miller?
Yeah, sure is, you guys. Yes. Is it
ever not time for Tab and Barney Miller?
I'd Tab and Barney Miller.
Sounds great.
I talk about Barney Miller a lot on the show because it's a show that seemed too adult when I was a kid. Seemed boring.
Yeah, right?
Same with MASH. And then I've rediscovered Barney Miller, and it's maybe my favorite sitcom. Like,
wow.
The writing is unbelievable.
Wow.
Every episode is a bottle episode. They In 200 episodes, they left that one room twice.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it all is just dialogue.
What?
And it's about cops doing paperwork.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's a famous saying that like all cops say that's their favorite cop show because it's the most realistic. Because there's never any action. It's literally just paperwork. And how Lyndon seemed like the kind of guy that you would want to be like, I just want to be able to tell him problems and he can go, okay, let's do this or whatever. Yeah.
Totally.
It's such a great show. And weirdly, was very progressive.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I'll watch it now and I'm like, I can't believe the conversation they're having on the show, like about like war and like gender relations and like gay rights and all this stuff in like 1975. And it's one of those things where you're like, were we a little more advanced in some ways when we watched
this? Doesn't it make you kind of think that though?
Yeah. Because this stuff would never.
We just haven't progressed as much as we think we have.
I think.
Sometimes.
Part of it is because I'm sort of fascinated by the very special episode sort of phenomenon,
yes.
Which that sort of falls under. But, and I've talked to a lot of people who worked on their shows because it's been like, what the hell?
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, well, people watch TV differently now. Like, people don't watch TV as a family or as a group.
You're right.
So you don't need to try to coat messages in with a show that's aimed at everybody.
Right.
So, because that was always weird, the weird tone shifts.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, we truly wanted to have like kids to be able to talk about a thing with their parents that they couldn't bring up. And if we're talking about the show, it's easier.
Mm-hmm.
And so that I'm like, oh, that makes way more sense.
So much sense.
But
that's
now
helpful.
Kids aren't watching, you know, I don't know what's on that
Barney
they would
Miller.
Watch Barney Miller.
We're not watching stuff together like we used to.
Right. You don't have to.
Yeah.
And especially sitcoms, which are
it's
mostly
so
like
separate.
Disney Channel now.
But wasn't it fun to sit with the family and watch stuff together?
Yeah.
I liked it so much.
Or even like as mortifying as it was as a kid when you watch something that you were
and
like,
and it's uncomfortable.
Uh-oh.
You're like, oh my gosh.
But I kind of feel like that was probably like character building.
Yeah,
a rite of passage. You're like, oh, they're kissing. Don't look at your mother.
Like,
yeah,
everyone's kind of like, oh, so, that was like an important thing you needed to do.
Yeah.
It was, man. There's a
beautiful
school break, CBS school break special on that day.
What was it?
Oh, this is a real important one. It's called The War Between Classes.
Oh.
They were just getting to know each other when they got caught in. Let me see what this is about. I loved those after school specials.
Oh, yeah, I loved after school specials.
And because you'd get them once a month and you were like, this is a big deal.
And they were like, the topics were like,
yeah,
good.
Same thing. Yeah, they were like, we feel like we're helping people here with this thing.
Mm-hmm.
It says close up on page A64. Where am I here? Sorry, it's sending me all over the world. Here we go. The War Between Classes starred Jan Gan Boyd and Don Michael Paul. Don't know them.
Ooh.
A high school social studies lesson in discrimination puts a strain on the budding romance between two of its participants. The students, divided by lot into three socioeconomic classes, must conduct their lives for the next month according to the rules of their stratum. Before long, the realities of prejudice become apparent, forcing Adam Tarcher and Amy Sumita to confront their own deep-seated prejudices.
Wow.
Put a mirror on that.
Yeah.
What? That's intense.
After school special. Yeah. That's what we're going to watch after school.
After school.
After school. Did you guys have anything like that in your school where you had to like do that class where, like, you're married to someone and you have to do, like, a budget.
I don't remember doing that.
Like, you have an egg baby.
I think they did in Home Ec.
Because I never knew anyone who did those, and I saw them in so many shows.
In shows. Yeah. I think they did in Home Ec, but I took wood shop. So.
What'd you build?
Yeah, dumb stuff, like pencil holders.
Spice rack.
Yes. Yeah. Nameplates for people, you know, like.
Nameplates?
Yeah. Like, for their desks that they didn't have. Oh. Like, I made one for my brother, who was younger than me.
Well, a desk was for the senior year project.
Yeah. Right. But yes, I didn't see a lot of that going around either. Like, egg babies and, yeah. Or flower babies.
Yeah.
Sacks of flowers. Did you do it,
yeah,
April?
I took in...
Did your baby survive?
Yeah.
How are they now? What are they doing
yeah,
now?
Where, my baby's doing great. Yeah. We didn't have the egg, or even though that seemed cooler, but like in high school, my junior year, we had a marriage and family class. And,
oh, sure.
They gave us like a real baby, and the baby record, like it had like a little recording.
Oh, it was a doll baby.
Yeah, yeah, doll. Oh, yeah, not a real baby.
I was like, what school system was this?
You went to an amazing school.
There's so many. It was a cool public school.
It was a secret access. Way for them to charge people for babysitting. Yes. They're like, no, we do babysitting. Kids, watch this.
Watch this baby.
Take this baby.
Yeah. You will be graded.
Sorry, like a fake baby.
It was like a Tamagotchi.
Whatever that is, I'm not sure.
Those little toys that they were like little pet keychain things and you had to feed
yeah.
them and keep
yes,
alive.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But it was like a proper baby size. But they only let you keep it for like 24 hours because there's so many kids to go around.
We only had one.
Yeah, we only had one baby. And I think I did fine, like a B plus maybe.
It didn't
That's
die.
Pretty good.
Yeah, it didn't die. And like when it cries and it records when you pick it up and stuff. But yeah, that's my story.
Oh, yeah. There's an episode of Silver Spoons where Ricky gets paired up with this girl and they have to do the married thing and do a budget. And she's actually a pregnant teen. And they find out halfway in between, and it's like a whole big deal. And yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. That was a very special episode. She passes out dancing at burgers because
no.
she's, you know,
no.
pregnant but doesn't admit it. And then,
so she wasn't admit. She, it's not that she didn't know, it's that she wasn't admitting
she
it.
She was ignoring it. Yeah.
Oh,
and, it brought up the surface because they would be like, oh, this is our budget. And then they'd get like things thrown at them by the teacher. He's like, we're having a baby now. And she's like, you shut up. You know, it's like that kind of thing.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
It's a little close to home there, does it?
And then Erin Grey had to be like, let me talk to you, you know, like comfort
her. Well, she was great.
I love Erin Grey, yeah. From Buck Rogers to Silver Spoons.
I mean, come on now.
What's wrong with that?
It's a perfect chance.
Her daughter was going to college in Boston and would bartend at this bar they used to do comedy shows at. And it was really weird because she's one of those daughters that it's like, was there even a dad? Because you just look like you've
exactly
been split
like
off from. And it was so weird because you're like, why is Erin Grey bartending? Because it was like she was the age that her mother was when she was in everything.
Right.
So it was
funny.
Just like, and then it turns out it was her daughter. But I was like, this is weird.
Yeah, that's right.
She was exactly, beautiful,
yeah.
Erin Grey.
She was the first actor to become an agent who booked actors at conventions.
No.
What?
Because she used to do
that's
a lot
so
of
wild.
Like signings and then was like, I'm just going to book people for
wow,
these.
Wow, that's smart.
Good for her.
She's very smart.
Became a businesswoman.
Smart lady.
Yeah.
Anything else on Monday?
Go,
oh, yeah, Joe didn't do her
first. I would have... I used to love Nick at Night, still do.
I love Nick at Night.
And that night they had Donna Reed and Dennis the Menace.
Mm-hmm.
I used to watch, like, The Many Loves of Dobie Gillis.
Oh, yeah.
I used to watch I Married Joan. I loved Nick at Night.
Do you remember when Nick at Night had their first original content?
No.
They did a show called Hi Honey, I'm Home.
No.
And the concept was they called it an instant rerun. So they did it in conjunction with CBS, and it was basically like a Monsters type show where this 1950s TV family gets put into 1991 or whenever the show was made. So it was like a Leave It to Beaver black and white family in like modern times.
Oh my gosh.
And it would air on CBS, and then the same night that episode would air later on Nick at Night, which is why they called it an instant rerun. And it was, they put a ton of money into it and it failed, but it was such a weird kind of fun
concept.
Yeah.
They tried.
They did because they were like, "What? We want something new that will appeal to people who watch all like Donna Reed and these things." Donna Reed I've revisited and like now, but at the time I was like, just seemed boring.
Yeah, there are a lot of that I like now, like Bachelor Father or, you know, like there are a lot of, you know, shows. Also, like, cartoons that were like from that, or maybe they were more 60s, like Wait Till Your Father Gets Home or something.
Oh, yeah.
Love that.
Yeah. Wait Till Your Father Gets Home, I think, was 71.
70s? Okay.
Yeah. And that was an adult cartoon that was like, it was like a sitcom. It was like All right. in the Family, but it was animated.
Yeah. It was good. I watched wow. it as a kid. Yeah. I don't know that I got what was happening, but I really liked it.
Well, people forget like the Flintstones and the Jetsons.
It was adult, wasn't it?
They were
it?
Adult nighttime yeah. cartoons. They were on at primetime and the sitcom lineup.
I didn't know that.
Weird.
That's interesting. Yeah. I used to watch Nick at Night, like at midnight, and they would like run through like Mr. Ed, the and like My Three Sons, and
My Three Sons was fun.
I just loved
Ghost and Mrs.
that.
Muir.
Dragnet was on.
Dragnet.
Patty Duke.
Patty Duke. They're cousins.
Yeah. Identical cousins.
I love Patty Duke. That show
so
was
good.
Very funny.
She was great.
Yeah, absolutely.
She's just brilliant.
I forget that she was in Valley of the Dolls.
Valley of the Dolls was good and weird and good.
And then I always forget that Sean Astin is her kid.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. Yeah.
So incredible.
So wild.
She had a show on Fox the first year Fox started, and it was called Karen's Song.
What?
And it was a sitcom, but it was about like a divorcee. It was just really, really sad.
Oh, no.
And she didn't get to do any comedy or anything. And I loved her show from Nick at Night because it was like sort of contemporary that they aired those, which I think is why they gave her the sitcom. Mm. You know, I was like 7, and I'm like, it's Patty Duke. And I was like,
oh,
this like sad divorce.
Like, I don't like this at all.
Who's your cousin?
What about Patty Duke? The same time I was watching Patty Duke, I was watching Gidget.
I loved Gidget. See, to me, I was obsessed with like Southern California, like beach culture.
Oh, really?
Because of Gidget and like all the beach party movies and Back to the Beach, which I love that movie. And if you've ever seen that movie from 89, it's Frankie and Annette coming back to the beach.
Uh-huh.
And like Pee Wee Herman's in it, Lori Loughlin's in it.
Oh,
but
my gosh.
There's like a pajama party dance scene, and it's at the end of Malibu Pier. Her apartment in the thing is right where Malibu Farm is.
Oh, how funny.
So, like, when I went down there, I'm like, it's back to the beach. It's
oh,
like, it's
that
ridiculous.
Feels so that's amazing.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Very fun movie.
Oh, I want to watch that.
So, when I've never seen Back to the Beach, it's super fun.
I want to see that. I have not seen that.
Writing it down.
I know.
If you like Annette Frankie Avalon, it's very fun. Because it's 20 years later from the 60s movies. So, it kind of. It's very winking and nodding, but also like weirdly referential.
Yeah.
And it has cameos by like Connie Stevens and Bob Denver and what's his name from Get Smart? Don Adams.
Oh, yes, Don Adams.
So all those like 60s actors in it. And the Leave It to Beaver kids. And,
oh, my gosh.
It's a fun, dumb movie.
Okay, we need to watch that.
Yeah. I know, I'm giving you guys too much homework.
So much to do. Tales from the Dark Side, Back to the Beach.
Weirdly, this night, Monday at 8 p.m., there's a pilot for an animated adult show at 8 o'clock called Happily Ever After.
Oh,
and this is
a
bittersweet cartoon about a girl named Molly Conway who's struggling to come to terms with her parents' breakup.
Oh.
So this is like a sitcom, animated sitcom about a divorce. Carol Burnett narrates.
What?
Other voices include Carrie Fisher.
What?
Henry Winkler.
Wow.
George Johnson. Danny DeVito.
You're kidding.
Rhea Perlman.
Oh,
anyone else? Dabney Coleman.
No.
Yeah, this is a good lineup.
This is great. How did
why
this
do I not remember
succeed?
This?
I don't remember either. It must have just been on the one time.
Oh, and then, they just one-offed it.
Oh.
What's it called? Happily Ever After.
We need to find that, too.
We can find it.
A lighthearted look at how one family deals with divorce.
I want to know.
A lighthearted look.
Yeah.
Maybe I can learn something.
This makes so much sense. Why have I been wasting so much money on therapy?
I know.
I just needed Henry Winkler.
I just needed the 70s or whatever.
Right.
Also, Kate and Allie that night.
Kate and Allie.
Yes, that was good stuff.
Kate and Allie.
That was like the cop one, right? One's the cop.
No, that's Cagney and Lacey.
They had daughters. Kate and Allie had daughters who were very opposite each other.
Yes. So the concept of Kate and Allie, much like Golden Girls, was these two divorcees can't afford to live in their house anymore, and they're old friends, so they become roommates with their kids, and they raise their kids together at this in this. I mean, it's basically a show about lesbians, but they never said it.
Oh, interesting.
But they raised,
I never.
Basically, I mean, they're best friends, but like if they made it now,
they love each other.
Would
Yeah.
But yeah, they're like raising their kids in Greenwich Village together, and yeah. it's a very sweet.
And the girls like had differences.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yep. There was one was more like a popular yeah. kind of girly girl, and one was like
a little kind of
into being in a band.
Intellectual. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
But a show that's all dialogue and is really like the relationship between them is really real and sweet yeah. and it's yeah. funny, and I love Jane Curtin and everything. She's always great.
She's great. Yeah.
Yeah. That's definitely a show I'd watch. And then Newhart, obviously.
You know, the Basketball Hall of Fame game was on that night.
Are you a big sports fan?
Yeah, I like sports.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I might now going back, I might be like, oh, who was playing then?
And the Basketball Hall of Fame is in Springfield, Mass.
Oh.
So I've been there, even though I don't like sports.
That's so funny.
Because they're just like, it's here.
Yeah, might as well see it.
You
yeah.
gotta go.
Was basketball the game, like the game you'd watch?
It was, you know, back, gosh, was it early 90s? Was the height of my love for the Lakers. I mean, of course, I've always loved the Lakers because home team.
And Paul Abdul.
I mean, let's call it yeah. spade a spade.
Yeah.
But I had very conflicting emotions back in the day because they were, you know, going against the Suns, and I loved Charles Barkley, and I still love Charles Barkley.
He's a personality.
He is fantastic.
Did you ever get into watching any sport?
That would be a negative.
Yes. Yeah, I have no clue. Yeah.
I don't know why. I loved, always have basketball. I mean, it's an unpopular thing to say, but I used to love watching boxing when I was a kid. I loved Sugar Ray Leonard.
Yeah. That's pretty amazing. Like, the lightweight fights, like, there's stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I remember you'd watch, like, Tyson or someone is like, they're hugging,
yeah.
done. Now no one's hit anyone.
That's yeah.
It's really boring.
Yeah.
Sweet yeah. science, they call it.
Yeah.
The sweet science.
Rope dope.
yeah.
Yeah. yeah. And you're just cool.
Yeah,
boxers would show up on sitcoms a lot, I remember.
They did.
That was weird.
Like on shows, like who had a lot of guests like that? Maybe like the Love Boat.
Yeah, Love Boat all the time. But even like Different Strokes, it would be like Sugar Ray Leonard
yeah.
shows up to teach them about drugs.
Right. Another very special
yeah,
episode.
Absolutely. Or there's like the one where he hires Mr. T to protect him
Mr.
from
T.
the Gooch.
The Gooch.
It's not a real school bully if it doesn't have a nickname.
Oh, the man. Gooch. The Gooch.
Did you guys have, was there nickname kids in your school?
I don't remember a bully like that.
Anybody? Nobody had nicknames.
Not many?
I don't think so.
I wonder if it's like, we
maybe it's an East Coast thing.
Yeah, everyone had one when I was a kid.
Wow, that's so cool.
The meanest one. This kid had a birthmark on his face. It was like kind of round. And they called him DB for donut burn.
Oh, no.
Because it looked like he'd been burned with a donut.
Kids are mean, man.
That's ruthless.
Yeah. They're mean.
That was there was that kind of level. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
neither
mean.
Were no nickname. I feel like this is an East Coast.
It
I
must
feel
be.
Like it must be.
There are kids whose real name I don't know.
Yeah, that's right. You just remember their nickname.
Yeah, there was a kid named Tooth. I don't know what that kid's
hey,
name
Tooth.
Was. Yeah.
You know what we did? I wonder, April, if in your school this was a thing. We called a lot of people by last names or first and last names together.
Yes, exactly.
That was very normal.
That was normal.
We had that too. Since my last name was just one syllable, it just didn't work.
It didn't work.
So, like, that one would never take, which I kind of felt a little bit like, yeah, you can't nickname me.
Yeah,
you were protected.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's
right. You
were protected.
Yeah, to this day, like, we went to a wedding of a kid that I grew up with, and a bunch of kids that we grew up with were at the wedding, and were drunk and obnoxious, and his last name was Dewar. During the wedding, they're just like, Dewar! Dewar! Like, this seems...
It's
yeah,
got to be Boston.
It has to be. It has to be.
Quickly, okay.
I do think that's
Red
funny,
Vines
though.
Or Twizzlers?
Yes.
Twizzlers.
Of course,
yeah.
It's because you're
it's
because
the Mississippi. Yeah,
we had a
Breyers
big...
and Dreyer's ice cream,
right?
Hellman's mayonnaise, and I think it's called like America's Best on this side or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
Mr. Pibb and Dr. Pepper. There's
Dr.
a divide.
Dr. Pepper.
There's a divide.
Yeah,
there is a divide, and
we're Red Vines.
We're Red Vines all
yeah,
the way.
Yeah.
Look, when I got married, that was a big. You know,
oh,
we're a mixed marriage.
Yeah. And your family was okay with that?
Barely.
Yeah. They're like, and Red Vines or and yeah, like, it's Twizzlers, and they're like, we need to talk.
Yeah, it was a
it's
problem.
Serious. Yeah.
Well, can Red Vines, can you use as a straw?
Yes,
yeah,
you can, because they have like two kinds. They're the solid kind that are smooth, or the twisty looking ones, you know, with the...
Yeah, yeah.
And those, we would bite them off at the end at the movie, stick them in our Coke,
okay, and watch the movie. Okay, because the Twizzler only has the one kind, and you can use it like a straw. Which, you know what, with the whole plastic straw thing...
Is a good
why
thing.
Why haven't they come back and been like... Edible straws, everybody.
Since the 40s. I'm just going to start buying red vines again.
Oh yeah. You'd think that would be the angle they'd take in their advertising.
We solved it.
Yeah.
Because those paper straws don't really work, especially if you're drinking a shake, milkshake.
You have to bring your own.
It's like edible plastic.
Yeah.
Like, that's perfect.
Twizzlers taste like wax to me. And red vines taste like deliciousness.
That's right.
And no one likes black licorice.
No.
Well, we can all agree on that. Should we move on to Tuesday?
Tuesday.
Oh, there is a world premiere movie on I just want to mention called Love on the Run.
Love on the Run.
This is on NBC. She's a brilliant lawyer. He's a man accused of murder. Mm. She'll risk everything to love him. She'll do anything to free him. Starring Stephanie Zimbalist of Remington Steele.
Oh, oh.
And a little actor here who's credited by his role in Knots Landing. Little actor named Alec Baldwin.
Hot.
Oh, I think he's going to do good things.
Yes, yes. He's moved on.
Talk about a smooth voice.
The weirdest thing is this picture they're doing, that like the kissing, they're...
You can't tell who
one's upside down.
Oh. Yeah, that's not a good kiss.
No, like I don't think that works.
Your chin's in my nose's way. Like,
their
what
chin,
is that?
Their nose to chin.
Nose to chin. I don't get that at all.
No.
How is that hot?
Run.
Yeah, no wonder this relationship isn't going to work.
Yeah,
they're confused how it works.
Yes. No. Mm-mm.
No way.
Mm-mm.
Tuesday.
back to
Tuesday. What did I? We'll start with April on this one.
Oh, really? okay. Tuesday I didn't have much, except my 5-year-old self would have picked the Daffy Ducks movie, Fantastic Island, playing on Tuesday.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, at 8 p.m.
This is when they would do those weird, super cheap new animation wraparounds, like Quackbusters, but for old cartoons.
Yeah.
And this one is Daffy Ducks movie, Fantastic Island, cast the web-footed star in a takeoff of Fantasy Island, which had been off the air for 2 years.
Oh, my goodness.
Plays host to such Looney Tunes legends as Bug Bunny, Porky Pig, Yosemite Sam, Speedy Gonzales.
All the greats.
All the great. I actually feel like I did watch this movie, and I think they're like trapped on an island.
And he's got the white suit.
Yes.
Montalban white suit.
Daffy Duck.
So good.
Where's that gold these days?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Is he your favorite of the Looney Tunes?
I do like, because he's a little aggressively angry, but then, you know, he's got a soft side, so
yeah,
I like him.
He's overcompensating for his insecurities.
There you go.
He's a complicated character.
I know a lot of people, myself included. No, I'm kidding. What about you,
Joe? Bugs.
Are your bugs?
Bugs is so on the nose, though, right?
He's the Angela Lansbury of Looney Tunes.
He is.
Just unflappable.
He is.
How about this? Bugs Bunny Solves Murders. New show.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
My hat comes off to you, sir.
We've probably made at least $2 million in new shows we've come up with in this episode.
I mean, we should probably keep this stuff to ourselves, you guys.
Well, what I'll do is I'll put this on an audio cassette,
okay. And
then I'll send it to myself at registered mail, and then it will be copywritten, even though that is not anything that would hold up in
a court.
So
no one can see. Yeah. But we could sure try.
You're a myth buster.
Yep.
That
was a classic, like, no, that's not a thing.
That's not how it works.
Yeah, you have to just register. It's not that expensive.
Just do it.
Yeah.
It seems harder to do it the other way.
Yeah, it really does. That's a lot of work.
That's a lot of steps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right up there with, if you're a cop, you have to tell me. No, they don't. A-Team is on this night.
I have the A-Team.
Did you do it?
A-Team. Also... it was a few games into the World Series where it's probably getting good.
It was 86 was when the Red Sox lost everything, right?
I think so.
That's when the ball went through the guy's legs and people tried to kill him in Boston.
Oh, no, Boston.
Yeah, it was the last. They hadn't been in the World Series since 1919, I think. Mm-hmm. And then in 86, they made it.
Mm-hmm.
And they would have won, but this guy, the ball went through his legs.
Can you imagine?
He had to have, like, police escorts.
Yeah, out. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can imagine that's the case.
He moved to, like, horrible. The mountains. Like, he had that to be,
poor,
like...
Poor guy.
Yeah. Away from society.
Yeah.
Can you imagine your life after that?
No.
No.
I.
No way.
Like, there are people in Boston who, if you were just, like... Well, he made a mistake. They'd be like, you need to move.
Yeah.
You've got 2 days.
Go now. It's for
your
whole health.
Family. Yeah.
You need witness protection.
Yeah, you're done.
Status.
You're done.
Yeah.
They take it very seriously.
Oh, my gosh.
This night is some goons are trying to force B.A.'s mother out of her Chicago apartment.
Oh, those goons in Boston.
Do you know who plays?
Cancel, cancel.
Yes. Do you know who plays B.A.'s mother?
Who?
As, first of all, she's credited as Mrs. B.A. Not Mrs. Baracus, which is her name.
Oh, no.
Because he's B.A. Baracus.
B.A. Baracus, yeah.
Mrs. B.A. is played by Della Reese.
Della Reese? No.
Yes, Touched by an Angel fame.
Wow.
I love Della Reese.
Wendy Shaw is in this, who has popped up in a lot of Joe Dante stuff. She actually replaced Hervé Valachez on Fantasy Island.
No.
So they first replaced him with Christopher Hewitt, who is Mr. Belvedere.
Yeah.
Which is a weird recasting.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
they were like, just to have it be like a young lady. And then the guy who's in charge of the goons is played by Ray Wise of Twin Peaks.
Oh, I love Twin Peaks.
Yeah. He's not Laura's father. Who's the Mr. Horn? Is Ray Wise?
Oh, right? The father.
No, Laura's father's Ray Wise.
Laura's father. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
oh
he's the head goon. Sending people after Mrs. B.A.
Mrs. B.A.
That sounds like some like a company that would help you graduate college.
It would. They should name it.
Yeah, hey, like a college prep course.
We have pictures. In the van. Remember when your car was shipped back and we went to get your car and we're like, that's the A-team van. So we snuck across the lot and took pictures of ourselves in the van.
We should let the world see those.
Oh, was this on like one of the lots?
Yeah.
Like for some reason my car was delivered to
Where was it?
I don't even remember anymore.
Downtown
somewhere.
But from across the lot, the shining, we're like, that's the A-team van. So we sneak over there and we go in it.
Exactly.
And we take pictures of ourselves in the A-team van.
I'm going to find those.
Yeah, we have
I would love
it.
To see that.
Yeah.
And also,
this was years ago.
Years.
Wow.
I weep for the current generation who has no iconic vehicles.
I know.
That's a really good point.
I could probably name
like
at least
Kit?
10.
Kit.
General Lee.
General Lee.
DeLorean
from
Back to the Future.
Why didn't they ever fix those doors?
Well, was it was down south.
It was functional too, right? For some reason.
Point.
Yeah. Yeah, the A-team van. Like there was a ton.
Yeah.
Nothing. Yeah, Street Hawk.
Airwolf. I bet we're going towards, like, no one's going to be driving in a few years.
Right.
I mean, or it's going to be all rideshare.
You would think that
the
cynic in me, which is a large part of me, wonders if a lot of those were, like, car companies who were like, how about they drive a Dodge van or something like that?
Right.
Maybe they're not, like, there's not some detective who drives a Tesla.
Right.
Maybe. I don't know. Maybe Bugs Bunny can drive one of these.
Bugs Bunny would.
Crimes. He would.
Yeah.
He would.
Yeah.
With his car runs on carrots.
That's right. Yeah.
Carrot
stubs.
It's totally green.
He's green. Bugs is green.
Anything else on Wednesday night?
Wednesday night. Harper Valley PTA on Wednesday night.
Based on the movie.
Yep.
Starring Jeannie herself.
Huh? Jeannie herself, Barbara Eden,
I never watched that show. Did you ever see
Harper Valley
PTA? I liked the theme song.
It's what a country kind of
right? And she's this mom who is like not fit for the PTA because she comes in her short skirt.
She's like a Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
And she's like,
too
I'm going to be
and all
on
the
this
moms
thing.
Hate her.
Yeah. And they're like,
they're
you're not
jealous.
Serious. They really are. Mm. That's always what it is.
Wow.
Yeah. Never seen the show. Seen a lot of ads for the show.
Yeah.
I feel like it wasn't that long-lived.
I don't think it was. And I do remember watching it a little bit, but I couldn't tell you, like, the nuts and bolts of it.
Yeah, I think you did.
I think that was
a great description. Yeah. It was a good pitch.
Do you have a favorite TV show based on a movie?
Favorite TV show based on a movie? Give an example, please.
There was Dirty Dancing. There was a 9 to 5.
There was a Dirty Dancing TV show.
It was really good too.
Was it really?
Yeah, it was an hour long drama
I
set in the past.
No idea.
There was Weird Science. There was a Ferris Bueller.
No.
There was.
I don't know any of these TV shows.
I'm trying to think of ones that may have gone on for MASH.
Mm.
There's definitely ones that went on for a while, and I can't think of them now. Gung Ho.
No,
like I don't know.
I didn't watch any of those.
Oh wow,
no.
No. No, 9 to 5 was pretty good.
Working 9 to 5?
Yeah, the Dolly Parton one. Yeah, they made a TV
series.
I do remember there being a TV series, but I don't think I ever saw it.
Uncle Buck. Clueless? Was it Clueless TV series?
Oh, there was a Clueless TV series. Wow. I do remember that.
Yeah. There was a few.
I don't know if I really got into it. No.
I think with the movie, and then we moved on.
Yeah.
It was always weird for the TV series based on the movie, because you're like, didn't we finish
this?
Didn't
we cover
this? The stories covered? Yeah. And it was always weird, too, because they almost never had the actors from it.
Right. And that's the
thing. So it was like, you're not my real, you know, my real actors.
Yeah. Don't mess with the closure that I got at the end of the movie.
There's a Fast Times TV series.
What? Really?
And it's really, really, really good.
Really?
And all the teachers from the movie play the teachers. But it's a whole new cast of Courtney Thorne Smith is in it.
What?
Yeah.
And Dean Cameron, 86. And it's really good. It's like single camera, no laugh track, like the same tone, like dramedy tone.
Wow.
And it's really good. And it only lasted, I think, 7 or 8 episodes.
Oh. But
like, that would be a perfect streaming thing.
That would be fun to stream. Like,
people would want
to
watch it.
I'd like
it
to see Courtney Thorne Smith pre Melrose Place.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, 87 was a big year for her.
She what did
was
she
in
do?
Summer School with Mark Harmon.
Summer School.
And Revenge of the Nerds 2, Nerds in Paradise.
Oh, yes.
Both of which came out the same week.
Wow.
She had a big week.
Courtney Smith week.
Wow.
She ruled the world.
It was the week of Courtney Thorne Smith.
Yes.
Where are we? We moved on to Thursday?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, let's do Thursday night. Helltown's on Wednesday night.
I don't know Helltown.
Starred, what's his name? The guy that murdered his wife.
Robert Blake?
Robert Blake.
Yeah.
And he played like a tough guy priest who was down in some South American border town
cleaning up the streets.
Yeah, it's real bad show.
That sounds hellish. That's
Helltown.
Yeah, right? Yeah, this hell says to watch.
His last name on the show was Hardstep. Father Hardstep.
Father Hardstep
fights a pimp and a cop to save a pretty young girl from the streets. And there's a drawing here that's amazing.
Oh, look at her expression, too. Look at all their expressions.
Dressed as a priest, and he's got like this fist up, like, come on.
I'm going to fight you.
Father Hardstep.
He's from Boston.
He might be.
I was just going to say, not like any priest I've ever seen, but you're like, oh, yeah, like all the priests.
Oh,
I've seen.
We had a lot of priests who were like, you kids get out of here before I kick your asses.
Yeah. I like it. It's clear.
Say four Hail Marys and then duck. Thursday night, I mean, I know what I would go with here, but. Who wants to go first? Anyone have a...
I have Family Ties and Cheers.
Yeah.
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 That's kind of what...
But also, what about Night Court?
I love Night Court.
Night Court was good.
Yeah. Night Court was made by people who all worked on Barney Miller.
Oh!
Stop it!
So it was like they were like the protégés of the Barney Miller show.
Yes.
So there's a lot of DNA that the shows share with each other.
That makes sense.
And Night Court's kind of like the goofier Barney Miller.
Yeah.
Gosh, it was good.
I love Night Court. Favorite character?
Bull.
Dan. Bull?
Dan. That was a Dan.
You're a Dan. That was Bull.
Yeah.
He's so
he was such a he should not have been likable.
No.
But Larroquette's so charming.
He did it.
Yeah.
You know, you're right. He was very charming and very lovable, even though he'd make you mad, but you couldn't stay mad.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it was always like he was a silly lech.
Yeah.
Like they'd do like weird stuff. And he was always, they'd write him as kind of pathetic as well.
Yes.
Yeah. He actually had to ask the Academy to stop nominating him for Best Supporting Actor Emmys.
No.
He won it so many years in a row. He was like,
what a nice guy
stop.
That he put a stop to it.
Yeah, he pulled his name out of the
running. You know what? He's great.
I love John Cutler.
I love him.
He's very private. I've tried to get him on the show. Doesn't like talking about himself.
Oh.
Very serious.
I love him even more now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's go find him.
We should find him, yeah.
Guys, that could be our mission.
The last thing I remember seeing him on was he was in an episode of Chuck, if you ever saw that show.
Oh, yeah.
No, of Chuck.
It was a fun show. It suffered from the fact that every season they thought they were canceled, so they ended the show every season, and then were like, oh, shit.
Yeah, got it. Rub it up.
Larroquette plays a character who is basically like a James Bond in the 80s, but is now kind of like a functional alcoholic. And he's kind of this sad guy who's used to be really suave and it's not quite working. And it's funny and like only he could pull this part off. It's very good.
He's wonderful.
Yeah, I would watch
him. And now I'd like to find him. And if he's that nice of a guy, he might not have us arrested.
That's true. He might just take care of business himself.
Yeah, that's true.
That's true.
He is a huge libertarian.
Oh.
Interesting.
And he also collects rare books.
I am in love. love.
Wow. I bet we can find him at Mystery Pier Books.
Yes,
yes,
probably. Yes. We just camp out there and wait for him to call.
The only reason I know that is because, do you remember the show Bloopers and Practical Jokes?
Yeah.
They played one on him once where his wife set him up and they went to an auction and there was a book that was not worth anything and they had her bid. Keep bidding on it, and he's like, "That's not." And she bids like $10,000 or something, and he's like, "No, no."
Oh my god,
that's a good joke.
It wasn't as mean as they normally got on that show. Yeah, I am watching absolutely that. I passed up the Cosby Show because Family Ties was so much better.
So much better. Yeah. Same.
Cheers is on that night as well.
Yes.
And Night Court that night is Mac's wealthy grandfather disowns him after learning that Mac is married to Quan Lee, who's left with little hope of buying a restaurant.
Oh no!
Yep.
Wow.
This was a really complicated relationship, if you remember the Quan Lee thing.
I don't remember.
So Mac was a Vietnam vet, and he saved her family in Vietnam. She was a little girl, and then her family had to flee, and he married her like as a favor so she could stay in the U.S. And then they like fell in love in real life. But it was a very weird.
Wow.
Like he was trying to help out.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
I love that show. Mac, underrated character.
Underrated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, indeed.
Very funny and underrated. Yeah.
This was a brilliant show.
It was a brilliant show.
Like, where is this running now? On Hulu?
It is on Hulu, and is Amazon Prime has Night Court as well.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they're both running. And Warner Archives put out all the seasons.
Okay.
As well.
Way to go.
But they don't get the cast that you remember of Night Court until season 3.
Oh,
like Christine wasn't the
oh, until Christine season was 3. There.
Roz didn't come in until season 3.
Oh, she was good.
Yep,
yeah,
was
yeah.
Great. Mac didn't come in until season 2. Like this,
I don't think I remember that. Oh my gosh.
Mel Torme, of course, was in all seasons. In spirit. And John Astin, who played Harry's dad, who's so funny on that show.
I forgot it's about amazing. That too.
Yeah.
I need to rewatch that.
No one plays a crazy person as well as John Astin.
That's amazing. And then there was a crossover in Cheers because Harry would go
Harry the Hat.
Right.
The magic.
Yep.
But he was a bad magician.
Yes.
He was like sneaky, right?
He was a con man.
He's a con man.
Yeah.
How did you feel about that crossover?
I liked that because he played those characters well. The weirdest cameo on two of the weirdest cameos on Night Court I can remember is Brendan Tartikoff, the president of NBC, was a guest star on Night Court once.
Because
the episode, a family got arrested for fighting, and they were a Nielsen family. And they were like, "You gotta let us out. Last time this happened, like, these shows got canceled and stuff." So Brendan Tartikoff shows up to bail them out because
that's
he's like,
"That's pretty funny."
It's funny because he's like,
funny.
"We're premiering a new show tonight. I need him to be
that's
home."
That's actually really good.
And then there's one episode where, for some reason, they have to finish like a ton of cases by midnight for some artificial reason.
I remember
that. Do you remember what the cameo is?
No.
It's basically like quick cut all these cases, and they show Harry, and he's like yelling at this person, like, "You got to leave them alone." And they cut, and it's Wile E. Coyote, like an actual animated Wile E. Coyote.
Oh,
it's the weirdest thing.
Oh my gosh, I didn't know.
Yeah, how as a kid, I was like, "What just happened?
How did they explain that?"
They don't
jump the shark.
It could have. It somehow works. Okay. Well, they thought they were canceled at season 8, and they wrapped up the whole show.
They're just like, "Let's go crazy."
But then they got uncanceled because the show that was supposed to replace it fell through, and they had to do another season. But they had like wrapped up all these major plot things. And the whole last season's just like, none of them want to be there. Yeah, it's just bizarre.
Oh,
right.
No.
They were like, we are not mentally prepared.
So you can skip that one.
Yeah.
Anything else we had on Thursday?
No, that's a brilliant Thursday night.
We have Knots Landing on with Alec Baldwin.
Oh.
And hold on. An actor named Hunk Block?
What?
Wow.
Never heard of this.
Summer
person.
Hires a manipulative new secretary played by Hunk Block.
Oh, Hunt.
Hunt Block. Hunt,
and that's a woman.
Yeah.
What?
Yes.
Well.
Hunk Block.
That's an odd.
Is that a stage name?
I don't
has
know.
Has to be.
No, you wouldn't do that, though. Why would you do that?
Well.
Why would you?
It's a man. It's a man.
It's
We've
a
confirmed
man,
it's
right?
a man. Hunk Block is a man.
It's a man.
That Hunt still Block. Doesn't make any sense.
Hunt Block. It doesn't even sound that good.
Yeah.
It sounds like a guy from those calendars that we were talking about earlier.
Mr. October's Hunk Block. Because this guy replaced my other favorite clearly fake actor name from the 80s, Dak Rambo.
I love that name. That's the best
he
name
ever. He guest starred in everything.
Dak Rambo.
Yeah. Oh, here's Hunk Block. Born. Oh, wow.
Is there
this
a photo?
Is crazy. Hunt Block, born as Huntington McDonald Block.
So it was his name. It was
Bless
his name.
Him.
Yeah. Hunt I got to see. If, is there a photo?
Graduated Harvard University.
Oh,
there's no photo.
It.
Still acting, apparently.
So he's super smart.
He's super smart.
Is there a photo of him on this?
Maybe he's a wasp. Maybe that's it.
They have those weird names. Huntington. Yeah.
Huntington?
Yeah.
Good looking fellow.
Oh, is he?
He looks familiar.
I'm Huntington Block. I went to
Wait, I've seen this guy and stuff.
Have you? Let me
he
see.
He looks familiar
Let me
to
see.
Me.
Can I see Hunt Block?
He looks very familiar to me.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he kind of has that, like, Dirk Benedict kind of look.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Hunt Block.
Hunt Block.
Huntington.
I'd go by Huntington, I think, if my name was Huntington, though.
Or Hunter.
Hunter would be pretty good.
Hunter would be good. Hunter
a
Block.
A lot of kids are named Hunter now.
Hunter Block sounds better than Hunt Block.
Hunter Block sounds like a punchline to a joke. Like, I barely know her. Like, that's, you can't.
Hunter.
Yeah. You can't do that
Hunter,
one.
Hunter.
Yeah, but yeah. Mm. Hunter McDonald Block.
Yes.
All right, Friday, final night of the week.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
What are we going with here? Who wants to go first? April, go first.
April, what do you got?
Well, I chose this because it reminded me of the show that comes on when my mom picks me up from the babysitter. Wheel of Fortune.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
But not such a thrilling show.
No. And also, how did Pat Sajak manage to convince people he was charming?
Nobody knows.
He had his own talk show.
He did?
Yeah, the Pat Sajak show.
Okay, I'm just going to make this. He reminds me of Ryan Seacrest. And
yeah.
I am not
a fan.
No one is.
I'm like, I don't understand why. Yeah. How did this happen?
Yeah.
No.
I mean, there is something to be said for, like, the most popular things are the most mediocre. Because that's just what appeals to the most people.
Right. The masses, right? Very even keel, very middle of the road, very vanilla.
Pat Sajak's just, like, just there.
Yeah.
Like, he's not, like, no one has an opinion on him.
Yeah.
No, but that's why he works.
I guess, yeah.
Because he doesn't piss anyone off.
Exactly.
He's got Vanna.
He's got, Vanna made that show.
They really tried to push for her to have an acting career. Do you remember that?
No.
And she's great on the show. She just doesn't. She just can't act.
She's
and
right.
They had a line of dolls. They had Vanna White dolls.
Oh, so
and
good.
She started a made-for-TV movie called The Goddess of Love.
Oh.
And the premise was Athena, I think, comes to modern day Los Angeles
and
wackiness ensues.
Oh my god.
I cannot wait to watch this.
It was like a Wonder Woman without the superheroics, basically.
Oh my gosh.
It was like.
Shoot.
That's like, what's that movie, Xanadu?
Oh yeah, Xanadu.
Xanadu.
It's like a they ripped
Olivia
off Xanadu.
Newton John. Yeah, oh yeah, she's a muse.
Yeah.
Is she a muse in that? Yes. I had Fee Wabel from the band The Tubes on, and he's in Xanadu.
Oh no way.
And he was like, it was the craziest thing on earth.
I bet that was a wild set.
Insane.
Plus, Olivia Newton-John, swoon. Wow.
Yeah.
Love her.
Yeah, all
love
in Venice her. Beach in 1978.
That had to be wild.
Sign me up.
Roller skates, Venice Beach, Olivia Newton-John.
Yes, please.
How did people survive that? That seems like, no one's the same again. So you did Wheel of Fortune, and then what did you do with the
I did, of course, there's Twilight Zone on Friday night, and Mr. Belvedere, because I loved Mr. Belvedere so much.
Do you have a favorite Mr. Belvedere episode?
Oh, gosh. There were so many good ones.
They had quite a few very special ones.
Well, they did.
They were one of the first shows to talk about AIDS.
No.
Wesley's friend at school got AIDS from a blood transfusion.
Oh.
And the school kicked him out. He's a little kid. He's supposed to play Lincoln in the school play.
Stop
and they're like,
it. Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
It was horrific. And then,
that's
like,
terrible.
George Owens is like, oh, geez, AIDS. And then Mr. Belvedere has to be like, let me tell you the myths about these things.
Oh, great.
Yep.
He's a great educator.
Yep. I've had two of the kids from that show have been on the show.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I had Wesley on.
Aww.
and Heather, who's now a real estate agent around here.
Oh, you're kidding.
Need to buy anything.
Amazing.
And wasn't the friend, am I mixing my shows up? It wasn't the they're a good friend, Angela? No.
Yeah, Angela, who would always call him like Mr. Bumbleshoot.
Yeah,
or Mr.
she never got the name right.
Beetleborg. Or, yeah, she never got it right.
She was fun.
Then Wesley's friend was Miles, was played by the same kid who played Alan on Punky Brewster.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my goodness.
Wow, really?
He was on two shows on two different networks. simultaneously.
That's amazing.
That would never happen these days.
No, it would not.
Mostly because you can't have a kid actor working right, two full-time gigs.
Right,
right. You're lost right. Now.
Yes, yeah.
They are lost. Yeah, yeah, there are protections these days.
But on
days.
Belvedere, they put him in huge braces headgear so that he could, like, differentiate between the two roles.
Oh, yeah. I remember the headgear.
Well, that's kind of clever.
Bringing the AIDS episode, the very special episode to that, do you guys remember going back to the Golden Girls when that AIDS episode? When
no.
There was an AIDS episode. Who was it? It was Rose or Blanche. One of them had a transfusion also. Now I want to Google it. And had to get tested, and it was about waiting for the results.
Oh.
Wow.
I remember the Designing Women AIDS episode.
Oh, what was that?
It's one of their friends, or he used to work for them, has AIDS, and then it's not Anthony, it's like a new character, and then Julia has this surprise, huge speech at the end of the episode, but it's like a very, like, these are people and what's wrong with you? It was like a very angry, and it got a huge amount of press at the time, and it got a lot of affiliates didn't air it.
You're kidding.
Yeah, they wouldn't air it. And then there's a Valerie's Family episode about AIDS that's maybe the most disrespectful one I've seen.
Oh, no. What happened?
The writers on that show just hated everybody.
Yeah.
And they fired Valerie from her own show. Mm. But there was an actor who played one of Jason Bateman's friends who I don't think want to be on the show anymore. And they wrote him off for a while. And the way they wrote him back into the show is Jason Bateman and his other buddy are, like, at a hospital shooting some documentary for college. And they run into this kid. And they're like, oh, my God, you know, how have you been? He's like, oh, I was in Europe for a while. And then he walks away. And they're like, hey, did you see where that guy went? And one of the orders is like, oh, yeah, he went over there with all the rest of the AIDS patients.
Oh.
And then they're like, what happened? And he's like, ah, I got it from some chick from Europe. And then he dies, like, immediately.
Oh, my
like,
God.
He's dead by the end of the episode.
What?
And there's also,
that
like,
doesn't make any sense.
It makes no sense. And all the other shows, they're like, oh, there's the myths. And, like, these are, this one's just like,
it
bye.
Didn't teach you
they're like, we're going to ride this wave of fear. We're just going to.
And now I remember it was Rose who had to get tested. And she says something to Blanche, like, you know, and she doesn't out and out say it, but there's a tense moment because Blanche, you know, had gotten around and she's like, me and not you. Type of thing. Yeah. And it was like
but that's probably what she would think.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, God. Yeah. Again, but those were important, I think, to like getting people to even know anything about that stuff.
Yeah.
Like Judith Light from Who's
Judith
the Boss?
Light. Yeah.
She was the one who got the Ryan White story made and was like big on, like single handedly produced that TV movie to get the word out about what that was about.
That's yeah.
And she still does a ton of charity stuff with AIDS foundations, you know, we're talking 30 years later.
Right.
So I think it's cool that those people had enough power to be able to get those messages out
and educate
the shows,
people.
Aside from the Hogan family, which was just punitive. best. Punitive at best. Punitive.
At best.
Is there anything you watch now from when you were a kid that's like a comfort show that you'll like go back and just kind of relax to?
I still watch Twilight Zones all the time. But Rod Serling.
Yes. Do you have a favorite?
Oh, I have so many favorites. I mean, I love the Talking Tina episode, but I do love the mannequins. Marcia.
Yes.
Marcia.
And Francis. Yes.
So good. Or the masks. That family. Oh, yeah.
Yep, they got to stay in the mansion.
Oh,
have you,
so good.
You've both been on the Paramount lot.
Oh, yeah.
I presume. The New York set. The Night of the Meek episode of Twilight Zone.
So
we went there and we walked around the corner like, Night of the Meek? Because the end of it's right on this one stairwell. And it was so weird how it was like just emblazoned in my brain. Do you have anything like that you watch?
I do the Golden Girls.
Okay.
Like, I put that on a loop. Like if I'm going through a breakup too, I'm like, Golden Girls.
Yeah.
On a loop.
Have some cheesecake. Sit around.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes, that's what I do.
It's they're important things to have to fall back on.
Little blankies.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Curling up.
And they all, both of those shows, I think, hold up today.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Both of those absolutely.
Shows.
And the new Twilight Zone's actually pretty good.
Yeah. I'll have to check it out. I was so excited for it. And I haven't even seen it yet.
One of my favorite, not even the CBS one. Not the new one.
The new one. Oh, you're talking about the old new one.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was one of my favorite Twilight Zones ever is on that, but I've gone through it on the show a billion times, so I'll spare them. But I'll tell you when we're done.
Yes. Love yes. To hear.
Well, thank you guys so much for doing this.
This was so much fun.
Thank you.
Thank you. So much thank fun. You.
Cool.
Feel it.
There you go. That's Joe and April. Love them. Cannot thank them enough for doing the show, especially Joe, who was suffering from an incredibly painful back that day, but came and sat down and talked nonetheless, and we had a great time. If you would like to request guests or just really say anything to me, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or kenatiKenRead.com. Also on other social media at TV Guidance or at Kenneth W. Reed, R-E-I-D. If you have a moment and you want to rate and review the show wherever you hear it, that is a huge help. If you shoot me an email also or a message, just let me know where you listen to the show. I'm just curious how you get it. It's I put it out on all kinds of different mediums, or not mediums, I guess vehicles or channels, or I don't know what they call them now, but curious to see how you hear about the show. So we'll be here again next week, I promise you, for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
If we jump to the future a little bit, in the past,